For the first time in 3 weeks, the Georgia Southern Eagles are back in Statesboro with a big-time challenge ahead. Upstart Coastal Carolina is trying to make things interesting in the Eastern Division, and with some severe weather in the area, who knows what's on the table? It's the Eagles and the Shunts. You're watching Sunbelt Football on ESPN3. Well, it's great to have you with us again today on ESPN3. Alongside Danny Waugh, I'm Greg Talbot, and Amy Zimmer joins us on the sidelines in just a minute. Well, Danny, we talked to both head coaches this week, and they both said the same thing. It's time to kick their seasons into gear.
That's right. Georgia Southern coming off of 16 days rest since their last game against South Alabama. Coastal Carolina lost last week to Georgia State. They have not won a conference game since last season, so it's a must-win game for the Chanticleers here this afternoon.
Well, the Shants run a two-quarterback system on offense under Jamie Chadwell, but really it's their running back CJ Mirabal that makes their offense go, and it's going to be a big running back day because for Georgia Southern, we learned during the off week that Logan Wright is going to miss 4 to 6 weeks with an injury, so it's the Oklahoma State transfer J.D. King sliding into that number one spot.
And J.D. King got more comfortable with this Eagle offense over the last couple of weeks, scored 2 rushing touchdowns in the last 2 games. You also have Wesley Kennedy back and his explosiveness. And for Coastal Carolina, C.J. Mirabal, 5 rushing touchdowns on the year, over 500 yards rushing. It's going to be a great running back game here this afternoon in Paulson.
Both of these teams could really use... All right, back with you here on ESPN3 as Coastal Carolina gets ready to take on Georgia Southern in Sun Belt Conference play. And Danny, these are two talented teams that are still trying to find their footing in the Sun Belt Conference. Let's take a look at the standings.
Yeah, and this is a must-win game for Coastal Carolina. As I said in the open, they haven't won a conference game since last season. Georgia Southern able to get that midweek win over South Alabama. They had 16 days rest. They are ready to go here today in Statesboro.
Well, we have a tropical storm in the area today here in Statesboro. It's not exactly the Hugo Bowl, but we send it now down to the sideline to learn more about the conditions from the bravest member of our broadcast team today. That's Amy Zimmer. Hi, Amy.
Greg, it's been raining the entire day, and it's only going to stay that way throughout the game. But rain or shine, nothing can dampen Georgia Southern's Military Appreciation Day. Now, the Eagles are going to be sporting helmets like this one here to honor the military and their sacrifice. Earlier this week, Georgia Southern head coach Chad Lunsford said, "We get so caught up in talking about football, but when we start talking about people who risk their lives every day so we can play the game we love, that's invaluable, and you can't put a price on the military." Now, this is Shy Ward's helmet, so I'm going to go take this over to him and also wish him a happy birthday. Greg, back to you.
Yeah, Amy, he might need that. Good idea to give it back to him, and a happy birthday to Shy Wirtz. There's Chad Lunsford, of course, took Georgia Southern from 2 wins to 10 wins last year. Daniel, when we talked to him this week, he said it's time for some momentum back in this program with a win today.
Yeah, this is a great momentum building. They have plenty to recuperate and look back at the previous 5 games of the season. With this 16-day break, these players have been itching to get back on the field, so expect Georgia Southern to come out with a lot of intensity here over Coastal Carolina.
All right, here is one of the best kickers in college football, Tyler Bass, to put it in the air for Georgia Southern against the Chanticleers. And back to receive Keon Tyler and C.J. Mirabal. Nice deep kick there from Bass. Back in the end zone, 25-yard line we go. Okay, Dan, we talked a little bit about injuries for Georgia Southern in the beginning of this broadcast, but turns out we had a last-minute change for Coastal Carolina as well. Fred Payton has been their main quarterback, although they do run a 2QB system this year. Turns out he is injured, did not make the trip, so we are going to see Bryce Carpenter taking the snaps today.
And Carpenter had a great game against Georgia State, threw for 2 touchdown passes, so I think he's ready to go the full game here today against Georgia Southern.
All right, so that is Carpenter. He's a sophomore quarterback, 6'1", 200 pounds, out of Sarasota, Florida. First play of the game, he scrambles up to the 31, 32-yard line. Pretty good scramble that time and turns it into a manageable second down, but a flag comes in from the secondary on the first play.
Yeah, things getting chippy early here, and you got to mention as well, Carpenter can run the ball as well, has 208 rushing yards entering this afternoon.
So the important thing is that although Fred Payton's been a good number one option for Coastal Carolina, Carpenter's been getting more and more time, most notably, Danny, because, like you saw on that graphic, 5 touchdowns, no interceptions. Payton has thrown 6 picks this year.
Yeah, 6 touchdowns on 6 picks.
Number 77 on the offense. That's a 15-yard penalty. It will be. Check it down.
All right, that was on Seth Harrell, the offensive lineman.
That is number 77, first unsportsmanlike conduct foul of the game.
Just like that, he's getting taken out. Sean Fitzgerald going to replace him on the O-line.
All right, so entering this game, Danny, you and I have been talking about this, as has the whole ESPN through crew all week, about what kind of game we expect to see today. With the weather in the area and two teams that are talented but with awfully good defenses, low scoring and tight seems to be what the experts are thinking.
And a lot of running. It's going to be interesting to see how Carpenter throws the ball, how that ball is going to move in the air with the tropical storm heading our way.
All right, second down and 19. Rashad Bird on defense moving up on the line for Southern. Carpenter out of the gun. They'll run the option on second down and 19. They will pitch to Jockeys Hairston. Stays in bounds up to around the 25-yard line before he's shoved out of bounds. Hairston, one of their secondary running backs, about 150 yards on the ground this year and three touchdowns.
And you may see him more involved because you don't want to overload C.J. Marable here throughout the afternoon. You want to save him for the key moments throughout this game and have Hairston get plays like this.
Harrison's got some real breakaway speed. He's so small and hard to tackle that he hasn't been taken down for a loss once this year. All right, big third down and call it a long eight for Coastal Carolina on their opening series. Two wide out split each way. High snap, looking left side. That one is hauled in by their leading receiver on the year, Javon Hiley, the sophomore out of Venice, Florida.
You saw the defensive setup for Georgia Southern. They were on a 3-4. You had split wide receivers on each side. It's going to be interesting how Kendall Vildor, who was on the coverage of that play, how he does the rest of the way, because Monquavion Brinson had an injury from South Alabama. He was listed day-to-day, and I believe he's out there on the field, and we'll see how long he stays out here throughout the afternoon.
We're all day today, Danny.
We got Justin Birdsong out there now, so Brinson not in.
All right, new first and down for the first and 10 for the Chanticleers. Carpenter's had plenty of time behind his offensive line on these first couple of plays. And they'll hand it off to Hairston for the second time. He powers forward for a gain of about 2 yards. And we talk about him as a small and shifty running back who's hard to tackle. 5'7", 180. He's actually a little bit of a bowling ball when you think about his size.
Yeah, and he can be quick out there on the field. Only got 2 yards there in the first play. But once this offense settles in, you can expect Hairston trying to make some big-time plays for Coastal Carolina.
Yeah, a couple of strong running backs on this Coastal team. Obviously, C.J. Mirable, first among equals, we have not seen take a handoff yet. But he's right there in the backfield, flanking Carpenter on second down and 8. Hiley back on the field in motion, into the slot. Trips receivers near side as Carpenter steps up. He'll run for the first down. He's got it and into Georgia Southern territory. Well, you mentioned, Danny, not only is he a good passer, but he's not afraid to run over 500 all-purpose yards already this year.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how much he attempts to run. Being the only quarterback in this two-quarterback system, it's a little bit different when you have two quarterbacks and you have more time to run the ball. But with him being the only one out there, he may play conservatively throughout this game, but already two rushing attempts this afternoon.
And Bryce had a really good game last week against Georgia State, 9 for 15 through the air, 120 yards. Two touchdowns, no picks. He actually had a better game against the Panthers than Peyton did. From the 15, new first down. They'll hand it off to C.J. Mirable in an absolutely brutal hit delivered. That was Randy Wade Jr. who took him down.
And Raynard Ellis was on the tackle as well, and that's something that's really been leading the defense this season, the interior linebackers for Georgia Southern. There you see Ellis had the first contact on the tackle with Randy Wade Jr. finishing the job.
Southern, one of the best rushing defenses in the Sun Belt Conference, second in the Sun Belt in yards allowed against entering this game. Second down and 9, play action. They're going far side. That one's hauled in by Hiley, his second catch. Flag comes in. He picks up a gain of 2, but we'll see who that one's against.
Well, great job by Kendall Vildor blowing up that play, knocking down the other receiver in Shadell Bell.
Offense, number 63.
So that's going to be on the right guard, Trey Carter, for Coastal Carolina. Either way, a great defensive stop there by Georgia Southern.
Yeah, no kidding. Although it is interesting. Obviously, Coastal Carolina more of a passing team overall than a rushing team this year. But are you a little surprised that we have seen so little of C.J. Mirabal on this opening drive for the Shuns?
It's definitely interesting to have Harrison be the guy in this opening series get the carries here.
All right, second down and 19 after the loss. Mirabal in motion. They'll run the option. Carpenter keeps, goes into the teeth of the defense, and is taken down. Second tackle already for Raynard Ellis.
Once again, the linebackers making that stop, and Raynard Ellis, second on the team in tackles, has 33 tackles, 3.5 tackles for loss. Not to mention a block kick from that Minnesota game a few weeks ago.
All right, big third down coming up here for Coastal Carolina. Third and 17, about 5 minutes into this game. They've already converted once on third down on this opening drive. 40% on the year. That's middle of the road in the conference. Mirabal, the man in motion. They'll run it, and it's not going to go nearly far enough. Only back to the 45-yard line, and that'll bring up a punt situation for Coastal as Hairston didn't pick it up.
Interesting there. They went for a run on third and long instead of trying to go for a pass. But nonetheless, great stop by the Eagle defense. They're going to get the ball here in a matter of moments.
All right, this is Miles Prosser back to punt it away. A couple of different kicking options every game for Coastal. It's always Prosser or Charles Overson to punt it away. And Wesley Kennedy back to run it back for Southern. He's at the 10. But he's not going to get a chance. Takes a good shot to clear bounce. And they're going to pin Georgia Southern down inside their own 5 toward the 2.
That was going to be another question when it comes to punts in this rain. How that ball is going to travel and how it's going to roll on this turf.
Looks like we have a couple of good punters in this game as well. We're going to take a quick break here on ESPN 3. Southern gets the ball. All right, after a good opening punt to this game from Coastal Carolina, Georgia Southern takes over for their first series on offense here. Danny deep inside the 5, and Shai Wirtz in his second home game of the year at Paulson Stadium after missing the first.
Yeah, we know how much time Georgia Southern takes time off the clock moving the ball down the field. He's going to pass on the first play.
He's going into coverage down the far side. That one is incomplete. No flag coming in. Pass intended for Colby Ransom. How often do you see Southern go to the air on the first play? Almost never.
Very rare, but I can understand why they went with it, because it's catch a defense off guard, because you're expecting a run first down inside the 5.
Chandler Crist on the coverage there. Really nice on defense. All right, Shai missed a couple games to start the year because of an injury he sustained at LSU, but since he's gotten back, Danny, he's really opened up the playbook for the Eagles.
Yeah, and you know he's itching for a touchdown. He has no rushing touchdowns on the year after being the leader for Georgia Southern last season.
Look at that great pitch. It's Malik Murray out of the backfield. He's got a first down and more to the 25-yard line. And you know, when we talked to the coaches, including offensive coordinator Bob DeBest this week, he said Shai's looked good since he got back, but hadn't quite looked at home running the option. That was the perfect decision as the quarterback.
Yeah, it took some time for Shai to get back in form the way he was last season, considering that he had the injury against LSU in the first game, missing a couple of weeks, getting back against Louisiana. Now he's starting to get in rhythm and settle in with this offense.
All right, so there's Wes Kennedy in the backfield. Came back last week after serving a 4-game suspension against South Alabama. Wirtz keeps here on first and 10, takes two guys to bring him down, and he picks up a gain of about 5 yards on that play. But there you see Kennedy on the right side of the screen. He is the junior running back out of Savannah, Georgia, went to Benedictine Military School. Last year, Danny, was his breakout year with this team. What is getting him back bring to this offense?
Well, it's very important to have him back. He was a key piece in the Eagles' win over South Alabama a few weeks ago. Once you get Kennedy in open space, he can make people miss. He's an incredible running back for Georgia Southern. Also plays a slot back, too.
Wirtz could have pitched it to him, and instead he'll keep and dives ahead to the 35-yard line for the first down. And another one of the things we talked about with the Southern coaches this week on our broadcast lead-up here, Danny, was they said the skill players looked good, Shai Wirtz looked good. They need the offensive line to really tighten up so they can move the ball downfield. pretty good-looking couple of plays here, as unfortunately we do already have an injury down. That is Evans for Coastal Carolina.
Yeah, Sincere Evans, the redshirt junior, down on the field following that play.
Looks like that might be his part of his right leg. But Danny, briefly, I would say if you're a Georgia Southern fan, you've got to be happy with the offensive line's look on these first couple of plays, right?
Absolutely. I mean, we talked to Chad Lunsford prior to this game, and he talked about, well, we'll talk about it more after the break.
All right, more after the break on ESPN3. All right, new first down and 10 for Georgia Southern as we come back from break in Statesboro. Great to have you with us. Eagles on their first drive of the day on offense. Dive ahead, goes for 3 or 4 yards on the play as Eagles keep this drive moving. All right, we saw an injury that we took to break. This was Sincere Evans in on the play. He appeared to be holding his right leg as he got off the field. The good news is, Danny, he didn't need to be carted off.
Yeah, you saw Michael Makins there kind of land and roll over Evans' leg, but he was able to get up on his own, walk back to the sideline. So he opened something severe.
I call that a gain of 5 yards. That was a handoff on that 1B. Taken up to about the 44-yard line. Looks like he got the first down. If he didn't, he's awfully close. Okay, then, we talked about him at the beginning of the broadcast. J.D. King has been picking up momentum as the season has gone along. Logan Wright's out at 4 to 6 weeks. He needs to be the number one guy today.
Well, you got to remember the story of J.D. King entering this upcoming season. We didn't know if he was going to be eligible to play this year, being a transfer from Oklahoma State. He was granted eligibility on August 19th. And at that time, during training camp, he was getting third-string, fourth-string snaps.
Southern runs the option. Good assignment defense here from Coastal Carolina, but not quite good enough. A 9-yard gain on the option for Wirtz.
Before the break, you asked me about the offensive line for Georgia Southern and how great it is to have a consistent O-line this week. They've had a lot of changes. I mean, with Jake Cooper now eligibly out for the season due to a medical disqualification, it was Aaron Dowdell that was taking snaps in the last couple of games. Throughout the first couple of games this season, they had some troubles with some high snaps. Now they have Peyton Backer at center for Georgia Southern. So they seem to have everything figured out here, had plenty of time to prepare this O-line. They should be ready to go.
That's LaRoche in the backfield. Second down and 2. Wirtz will keep off play action. Spins forward, and I don't think he got there. That's maybe a gain of 1 on the play, but that'll bring up third down and short.
Michael Makins halting shy from potentially getting that first down, and he will be short, so it'll be third and 1.
All right, so Coastal Carolina is okay on third down. Georgia Southern, in comparison, the worst third down offense in the Sun Belt Conference this year, about 25%.
Yeah, and we asked Bob DeBest about that a few weeks ago, and he said that he doesn't look at the stats at all.
Third down in inches. They'll feed J.D. King from Fitzgerald, the Oklahoma State transfer. He falls forward to the Coastal 45. Looks like he got that by a couple inches.
It'll be a close one. You saw Makin saying that he didn't get the first down.
Maybe not. We will see. He fell forward.
It's like it's 4 inches.
Yeah, if his knee, they're going to say his knee was down as he fell forward. So this is fourth down. Southern appears to be going for it. Eagles 1 for 2 on fourth down so far this year. They don't go for it very much.
Well, as far as Georgia Southern tradition, Eric Russell always said one more time, so they're going to give it a shot here on 4th and 1.
That's King and Kennedy in the backfield on 4th. They'll feed to Wesley Kennedy. He powers forward to the 44. He's still on his feet. He's down to the 32-yard line. What a run for the Savannian.
That's big. You saw he went right into that pile of linemen.
I could have sworn he was going down.
Yeah, I thought he was going to run in to try to get down, get the first down, but he bounced out and got some extra yardage on that play. That's the agility and quickness of Kennedy that the Eagles were missing their first 4 weeks. You saw that Kenny Gallagher.
Yeah, what
was
a
trying to tackle him.
Gallagher, holy cow. All right, new first and 10, and Georgia Southern's got some momentum. Coastal brings up a safety anticipating the run, and they did the right thing. Down goes Shai Wirtz, and that's Ryan Lee, the junior linebacker on the tackle.
Well, now it's the second tackle for loss on the season. Lee, the junior from Columbia, South Carolina. Deshaun the Clears run a multiple spread on defense, and that was a great job covering the option.
Certainly did, and one thing that we've seen them do well on defense on this opening drive for Southern is, although the Eagles have moved the ball well, Coastal is playing their assignment defense. They're not abandoning their posts.
Not at all.
All right, after the loss of three on the play, second down and 13. That's J.D. King in motion. Not much of an offensive line here as they hand to Kennedy. Takes a couple of shots, clears with him down to about the 28-yard line. He's not going to pick up the first down, but he's only about three or four, maybe a long four short.
We talked about how King was going to have to be the primary running back for Georgia Southern this afternoon, already with four carries.
Called this third down and six. Okay, King, leading rusher on the year. Not surprised to see him back in this formation outside of Logan Wright. Logan Wright going down this week. He was their leading rusher on the season. King now in there in the backfield. Hand it off to him and it goes nowhere. All right, so it's going to be fourth down. And Tyler Bass is one of the best field goal kickers outside of the Power 5. In fact, people in the Sun Belt would say he's one of the best kickers in college football, period. But there is wind, there is plenty of rain, there's a tropical storm in the area. This is going to be asking a lot of Tyler Bass.
And keep in mind as well, he's 12 of 15 on field goals and missed a few at South Alabama in their last game. But he did get the game-winning field goal to win the game over the Jaguars in double overtime.
This one is just north of 45 yards. That one's got the distance, and it's right through. Eagles get a field goal on their first drive. Not bad. All right, that'll take us to break here on ESPN 3. Nice drive from inside their own five, and the Eagles are up three. Well, there's Jamie Chadwell in his first season as the new head coach at Coastal Carolina after serving as an interim and a head coach in waiting the last couple of years.
Yeah, he came over from Charleston Southern, was the offensive coordinator. Joe Mongoli, who was the current head coach at the time, had to take a medical leave of absence. So Chadwell was the interim head coach. He went 3-9 in that year, returned to being the offensive coordinator in 2018, now in his first full season as head coach here in 2019.
That one nearly good for a field goal from Tyler Bass, and Coastal Carolina will take it from their 25-yard line. Okay, so in case you're just joining us here on ESPN 3, Fred Payton, the normal number one quarterback for Coastal Carolina, although they run a 2QB system, sounds like he is injured. They didn't tell us that until almost right before kickoff, so apparently he didn't even make the trip, so Bryce Carpenter is the guy today.
And he's already had three carries for 19 yards, being a dual-threat quarterback. Both him and Payton dual threat quarterbacks in this two quarterback system, but Carpenter being the solo man here this afternoon.
Completed one pass on that first drive for 10 yards to Hiley. He'll go to the air on the first play of the second drive. Flag comes in. That ball is ripped down by Kendall Vildor for Georgia Southern. The question is, will the interception stand? The Southern defense is reacting like it does, but we will see. Two flags in from the far side now, actually.
Yeah, you got to hope it's not pass interference. If you're Georgia Southern.
Holding. Defense.
On the safety, Kendrick Duncan Jr. So not only did his Coastal get the ball back, it's also a new first down.
Oh, and that's got to hurt for Vildor. He had great coverage on that play. He was the Sun Belt Conference preseason defensive player of the year. Great coverage on Isaiah Likely.
All right, so a second chance of life on this second drive for Coastal Carolina. We're going to move that ball up towards the 35-yard line.
So they're changing it. So the holding was on Vildor as well when he got that pick.
Interesting. Okay, I was going to say I didn't see Duncan quite.
You saw Duncan running in at the end of that play.
That's the correct call. All right, so there's Rashad Byrd, the middle linebacker, kind of calling out that play as Carpenter keeps it himself. He scrambles up toward the 44 before he takes a big hit as he goes down. Maybe just a little bit short of the first down. Pretty quick first quarter going by, only a minute 15 until we're done.
And a good job by the offensive lineman for Coastal Carolina being able to make a hole for Carpenter. He's been able to get about 7 or 8 yards every time he's ran down the field.
Hasn't gotten quite as many snaps this year as the normal QB1 Fred Payton. Carpenter gets a third or fourth of the snaps, but he's been awfully effective this year. Whistle's coming in.
The previous play is under further review.
Well, they're going to say the previous play is under review. And
Was the 8-yard scramble? I think because Coastal got that play off, I would imagine they aren't allowed to review that.
No, end of that play, you had Kendrick Duncan kind of go in late on the hit as Carpenter was going down on the ground. So they could be reviewing that play for targeting or something like that. We'll just have to wait and see. Because you are right. You can't review the previous play where Vildor had the holding call.
Right. All right, we'll show you the first look we are getting at this.
So you see as Carpenter goes down.
Okay, they might be reviewing that for targeting because we saw helmet on helmet that time from the safety Kendrick Duncan.
Well, for a moment there, like Duncan led with his shoulder. There are new rules when it comes to targeting.
They might be reviewing this for targeting is what I'm thinking right away. We are being told they're looking at Duncan for targeting. That's what we thought.
After further review, there is targeting on the defense. Number 27, down of the helmet, 15 yards from the end of the run. First down, Coastal Carolina.
So two automatic first down penalties for Coastal Carolina here as Duncan is being escorted off down toward the other side of the defense.
Yeah, that's got to be frustrating because you had the great play, and there you see the targeting rules. And Kendrick Duncan is disqualified from this game.
And that's an absolute nightmare because although Monquavion Brinson is playing right now for Georgia Southern, he was banged up after that South Alabama game. He was day-to-day, so now not only is Monquavion maybe not quite 100%, you just lost a safety who has two interceptions this year.
Yeah, two interceptions leading the team. That's going to be a big blow to this Eagle defense. Trey Cofield will likely step in as the backup at free safety.
Well, this is bad news for Southern as Carpenter will keep on the fake pitch. Dives toward the 30-yard line. He's got a first down, and here come the shots.
Well, a beautiful fake by Carpenter. And here's going to be another look at that targeting call on Kendrick Duncan.
And there's a flag on that last play, too.
Yeah, he led with his helmet. For a moment there, I thought it was a shoulder, but it was the helmet.
Yeah, it was.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct on both teams. Number 5 on defense. Number 3 on offense. Those penalties were offset. That is both players, both unsportsmanlike conduct fouls.
All right, so that's Tequil Holmes, one of the running backs and wide receivers for Coastal Carolina. And then on the Southern secondary, that is, of course, Jay Bowdry.
So you've had a couple of bad calls on the defensive side. And if you're Scott Sloan, a defensive coordinator for the Eagles, you're telling them to remain composed. You can't let these penalties get the best of you.
Yeah, this is a wild drive if you're a Georgia Southern fan. You've got to be losing your mind.
Now, luckily, both of those unsportsmanlike conduct penalties offset each other, so there's no progression down the field for Coastal. However, that was a great run by Carpenter.
And their offense is really picking up momentum on this drive. It's all been on runs and penalties, and they feed Hairston. And a flag comes in from the far side again. There's laundry all over the field here in the first quarter.
Already two unsportsmanlike conduct penalties.
Illegal formation, offense. More than 4 in the backfield. 5-yard penalty, replay, first down.
All right, the Eagles finally catch a break on this drive.
It was a great defensive stop regardless. Good tackle by Chris Harris Jr.
All right, nonetheless, Coastal throws over the middle and has this one incomplete. A running play would pretty much end this first quarter, and as the clock drips down, it looks like that will take us to the end of one here from Paulson Stadium. Not exactly the Hugo Bowl, but the weather is not helping matters with passing here. 3-0 Georgia Southern at the end of one on the Trace, ESPN3. Well, despite the bad weather today in the Southeast, plenty of good Sun Belt Conference games on tap. Danny, the one that speaks to me, I know it's a non-conference game. The fact that Georgia State is only 4.5-point dogs against Army, that's very impressive.
And Georgia State's 4-2 on the year, already had a monumental opening win in Knoxville against Tennessee. Appalachian State ranked again for the first time since last season. They were ranked 25th last year and lost to Georgia Southern in Statesboro.
All right, back here. Play action pass going deep for Isaiah Likely. And he's into the end zone. Coastal Carolina takes a 6-3 lead. First play of the second quarter for the Chanticleers. It's the sophomore tight end.
Well, throughout this drive, you saw Georgia Southern get frustrated with penalties, including the targeting call that took Kendrick Duncan Jr. out of the game. Carpenter able to go deep to Likely. That's Likely's third touchdown this season.
All right, here's Massimo Biscardi in to put the PAT through for Coastal Carolina. Nails it, and it's a 7-3 lead for the Chanticleers. So Isaiah Likely, in addition to being fast, you might not know based on how fast he is, how big he is. He is 6'4", 245 pounds. And here's the thing, Danny. He's got a history of being awfully good against Georgia Southern. The Eagles defense did not have an answer for him. Last time they played him, he had two touchdowns against the Eagles in their last meeting.
And as you saw in that previous replay, that was a great blocked by the running back, giving Carpenter time because Chris Harris Jr. was about to go for the sack on Carpenter. And Carpenter able to get the ball off at the last second. Beautiful touchdown pass to Likely.
All right, there's Wesley Kennedy back for his second game since returning from that suspension. Although, Danny, I'll tell you, he made plenty of impact in that game against South Alabama where he returned. They wouldn't have won that game without him.
Yeah, and if you recall last season and how much of an impact he was for Georgia Southern, scored the game-winning touchdown against Arkansas State here in Statesboro, being able to score a touchdown against South Alabama to help the Eagles win that game in double overtime. See what he can do here in his next drive.
He'll let it go over his head into the 25-yard line they go. Okay, so if you're a Georgia Southern fan, obviously not happy about getting beat over the top with the loss of Kendrick Duncan. You have to wonder if Kendrick Duncan not having been ejected for targeting would have changed the outcome of that play.
I don't think it will because the Eagles had the same problem against South Alabama because the two touchdowns that the Jaguars scored was over the top, deep ball passes for touchdowns.
Which is so funny.
Something definitely worked on.
That's really been the catch-22 is Georgia Southern is so well thought of with their secondary with Brinson and Vildor and Bowdry and Duncan, such great secondary players. And yet, when they've gotten beat this year, it's largely been over the top because it's been their run defense that has been so good as LaRoche picks up a short game.
I was about to say, it's always been the Eagles' Achilles heel throughout the last couple of years. They've always had a solid interior seven to stop the run game, but when it came to the deep ball and passing, it was trouble. But with Vildor and Brinson over the last couple of years, they developed into the great cornerbacks, but they've had some troubles this season as well.
My mistake, that was J.D. King on the run. That is his sixth run of the day. That puts him over 20 yards. Shy has kept it five times. King's taken it six times. One run each for Murray and Wesley Kennedy. Second down and seven. Wirtz looking downfield again. Comes to the sideline. He's got Kennedy for a first down. He's past the 45.
And that's deep. Dual threat of Wesley Kennedy being a great running back and a great receiver as well.
That was the thing when he was really introduced to Georgia Southern fans last year. The first half of the year, it was really more as a running back. He changed the whole offense when he moved into the slot as a part-time receiver as well.
Yeah, and you remember with those first four games he was out for, and we talked to offensive coordinator Bob DeBest, they were trying to go for a two-for-one and have J.D. King and Caleb Hood try to make up for that absence.
All right, four down linemen for the Shants on first down. Hand off to Speedy LaRoche, gets back to the line of scrimmage and maybe a yard on the outside. And you know, when we talked to Eagles offensive coordinator Bob DeBest this week, Danny, we kind of asked him who's going to step up in place of Logan Wright. Their leading rusher is gone for 4 to 6 weeks. They said J.D. King is really going to be number one, but they are counting on LaRoche to pick up more than usual on those fast runs.
Well, you got to remember, at the beginning of the year with Logan Wright and Matt LaRoche, it was kind of a mix of thunder and lightning. So now you need lightning to step up here in LaRoche. has 226 yards entering this game and a touchdown.
All right, second down and nine. They'll run the option. This is Caleb Hood, the true freshman, down the sideline toward the 25, and a big breakaway for the 5'10", 170 true freshman out of McDonough, Georgia. Speaking of that Coastal defense, we have an injury update from Amy Zimmer.
Sincere Evans go down. I talked with Coastal Carolina. They told me that he sustained a lower body injury, however, is returning to the game as we see him out there right now. Back to you.
All right, thank you so much, Amy. New first and 10 for Georgia Southern, down inside the 30-yard line of the Chanticleers. Handoff goes to Kennedy, tried to cut it off tackle and taken down for a short gain on that play, but Danny, it was Caleb Hood that took him all the way down into Coastal territory. He has been a revelation as a true freshman.
Yeah, I was about to say, Caleb Hood was able to find some open space. Before that, he only had two rushes for 12 yards, mainly being, for the most part, being a receiver with four catches and 65 yards. So now, getting more settled in with his offense, able to create some positive yardage.
Even more than that, even as a true freshman, he's been their leading receiver on the year. Second down and seven. Wirtz the option. Coastal read that thing just right. Taken down to the 21, short of the first down. 2 or 3 yards to go, and that brings up a tight third down here for Southern.
And this is going to be interesting to see what the Eagles can do, getting closer and closer to the red zone. That has been somewhat of an issue for the Eagles so far this year, mainly settling for field goals and not able to get to the end zone.
Yeah, Georgia Southern only now 6 touchdowns on 18 red zone trips. They've settled for a lot of field goals from Tyler Bass. All right, call it third down and 4. Big line bunch formation for Coastal Carolina. Wirtz under pressure. That ball's on the ground, recovered by Wesley Kennedy, and actually he fell forward. He might have picked up the first down in the process.
Yeah, it was a great job by the Chanticleer defense. They showed 5 on that play. The option worked well. They fell for the handoff, and Wirtz kept it. As he went down, the ball went out. Kennedy able to cover.
Yeah, they are going to give the Eagles the first down, and color me surprised on a couple of things here, Danny. We know that Shai Wirtz has not thrown an interception in over 125 passes. He almost always holds on to the ball, too.
Yeah, that's rare when you see Wirtz fumble the ball like that.
And he'll pitch to Kennedy. He turns upfield. Down to the 12-yard line, picks up about 5 yards in the process, and this Eagle offense is starting to pick up some steam in the red zone.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see if they can get in the end zone. You brought up the interesting stat about their red zone opportunity so far.
Yeah, Bob DeBest, when we talked to him, the OC this week for Southern, said that it's almost been a blessing and a curse because they know they can rely on Tyler Bass, but they would like to rely on him less.
Right.
All right, down inside the 10-minute mark until halftime. Eagles back in the red zone. Caleb Hood, the true freshman, goes in motion. Linebacker blitz coming. They'll feed J.D. King. Falls forward to the 10, short gain, and it's another third down.
It was a shoestring tackle there, but called it right there before the play started. A linebacker blitz up the middle, blowing up that play. Now it's 3rd and 3.
All right, call that now 7 carries on the day for 25 yards for J.D. King. He's been building game after game, and especially with Logan Wright out these next couple of weeks, they're hoping that today is the first big game for J.D. King.
Yeah, we'll see how that goes as the rest of this game plays out.
All right, big 3rd down and 3. Cam Brown, it is the tight end, providing an extra body and an excellent lead block. Wirtz is down to the 6-yard line, and he picks up the first. Great lead block from Cam Brown.
And also another great option play by Shai Wirtz as you're starting to see him get more comfortable throughout this season. Even faking out the cameraman on that previous play. He's done a great job stopping this Coastal Carolina defense too. And there you see they were going for LaRose. No one saw Wirtz until the very end. And Laquavius Paul making that tackle.
All right, Eagles down inside the 10 now at the 6-yard line. So 1st and goal. And that's J.D. King in the backfield. Trip set to the top of your screen. But they're just decoys as King takes it down to the 3-yard line. trying to make a little more space by pulling all those corners off to the left side.
Yeah, and giving plenty more space up the middle, but King only able to get 3 yards on that play.
Had an awfully good touchdown called back and then made good for it in Southern's last home game, which, believe it or not, was already 3 weeks ago against the Raging Cajuns. That was a loss, but JED looked awfully good in that game. Got down to the 4, second and goal. Secondary is sitting there waiting for the option. They'll have to defend it. And Wirtz gets back to the line of scrimmage, third down.
Jordan Morris on the tackle, and you had plenty of blockers up front. You had 7 down linemen.
They had that one sniffed out. The linebackers all stayed back. They were ready for the option.
Yeah, and you may see that a lot more here. It's going to be interesting what the Eagles do on third and goal. If they're going to run it, they go for a quick pass. We've seen that before from the Eagles as well.
Once again, Southern, 6 touchdowns only on 18 red zone trips. They would like to not settle for Tyler Bass in a field goal. Looks like a timeout. And we'll take it with him here on ESPN3. Huge third down and goal coming up next for Georgia Southern. Well, Georgia Southern has not scored a ton of touchdowns in the red zone this year. Third down and goal from the 4, Danny. What are we about to see?
Well, I would assume you go for a fake handoff and have Shy run up the middle, because you've seen the linebackers for Coastal Carolina read the option very well throughout this drive.
All right, Tony Romo, here we go on third and goal. King and Kennedy in the backfield. They're going to feed West. Kennedy. And the Savannian has a touchdown. Eagles take the lead. We had a feeling that since Logan Wright was out, Wesley Kennedy would be a big step-up player. Certainly has been in big spots so far. Don't forget he had that big 15-yard catch to get him past midfield.
Yeah, and once again, the Eagles going with 7 down linemen up front. Great blocking. You had Kennedy go straight up north to get the touchdown. Now, that's what you called during the commercial break.
I'll take credit for that.
You'll take that one. I thought we were going to go with Shy Wirtz, but
I'll take credit.
Going with Kennedy and just knowing how explosive he can be, and we'll get the touchdown and get the Eagles the lead.
Kennedy seems like the natural X-factor option today for Georgia Southern. This for a 3-point lead from Tyler Bass. He's got this one, and Danny, I'll say this as well. The rain and the wind does not seem to have made much of a difference in the kicking game today.
And the rain here has been picking up throughout this day, and we'll see how much it carries in as this game progresses.
All right, quick break. All right, Eagles take the lead 10-7. And Danny, it's not quite the Hugo Bowl today with a tropical storm in the area, but Southern's got a history of playing games well in the rain.
Yeah, you got to talk to some alumni from the late 80s and early 90s that can remind you about the Hugo Bowl. September 21st, 1989, a hurricane was making its way towards Statesboro on a Thursday night, and Georgia Southern had a big Thursday night game on ESPN against Middle Tennessee. They won that game 45-3, and they played that entire game throughout the horrible conditions, and there was a ton of fans out there just enjoying the elements and the atmosphere.
Pretty good crowd, actually, in terms of the student section on the far side of the field. I've been proud of the students today for coming out.
Yeah, they have, rain or shine, they're making their way out to support Georgia Southern. I mean, this is the first time the Eagles have been home in over 3 weeks.
Yeah, 3 weeks since they played the Raging Cajuns at home, but today it's the Chanticleers. Bryce Carpenter going out of the gun here for Coastal from the 25. Starting their third drive. He'll try to tuck it and run, and is taken down for a short gain on the play by C.J. Wright.
Yeah, I was about to say, the Eagle defense got fooled in that previous fake toss before, but this time Wright was able to catch it early and make the tackle. What's interesting here is that we haven't seen much of C.J. Marable. Only 1 carry, just 1 yard, and he was a guy to be highlighted at the open of the broadcast.
Sends a man in motion, and they will give it to Mirable as he sweeps along the outside. Pretty much no gain on the play, and the Eagle defense had that one read just right. First one there, Reynard Ellis, his third tackle already, along with Monquavion Brinson, who appears to be healthy.
And there was no space for Marable to cut open on the field and jump ahead.
So, like you said, Danny, it is a surprise. We've not seen much of CJ. He's their leading rusher on the year, 500 yards, 5 touchdowns. That said, he had a really bad game last week against Georgia State, only 18 yards on 10 carries. Big third down and 9. Two receivers split out each way. Carpenter looking downfield. Pressure from the side. Here comes Mirabal on the screen play. Stays on bounds. Turns up field. No one knows exactly where he went out of bounds. He may have picked up the first down, though, but the referees are going to tell us exactly where he planted that right foot.
Well, I do believe that he picked up the first down.
I think he did by about 5 yards, but we'll see.
Here's another look. Carpenter under pressure. Marable able to get the pass. And right there, I think his right foot stepped on the white line. But he did get the first down for sure.
All right, they're going to mark this ball at the 39. So they're going to say he pretty much turned up field, planted his foot out of bounds, but picked up the first down on the way around the corner.
Yeah.
All right, here comes the blitz. Carpenter steps up and runs. And the Southern defense takes him down for a short gain. Maybe 2 yards on the play. Randy Wade Jr., the one there first.
These linebackers are leading this interior seven. I mean, you look at Randy Wade, Rashad Byrd, and Reynard Ellis. They all do a great job preventing running backs from getting good yardage.
Yeah, Reynard Ellis has been a monster today, huh?
Yeah, him and Rashad Byrd. I mean, Rashad Byrd entered the game leading the Eagles in tackles with 38. 5 tackles for loss.
All right, that takes us down inside the 5-minute mark until halftime. Carpenter tries to run the option and is spun down for a short loss. Southern's defense had that one sniffed out. And once again, would you look at that, Randy Wade.
We're definitely seeing a more composed Georgia Southern defense, different from when we saw on that drive where Coastal Carolina scored. You had a targeting call, you had the holding call on Kendall Vildor as well that would have been an interception if he didn't get called for holding.
They're going to call it a loss on the play. Third down and 8 and down inside 4 minutes now. Carpenter 4 for 4 on the day. No incomplete passes yet. 4 for 4 for about 60 yards. Only 3 down linemen for Southern. Timeout on the field.
Timeout. Coastal Carolina. Their second charge timeout.
And that one is called by the Sean Clears. We'll take a quick break here on ESPN3. Back with a big third down and long for Coastal next. Well, it's Military Appreciation Day at today's game. So coming up at halftime, we've got a special feature story, if I can speak English, about Georgia Southern's nationally recognized ROTC program. Meanwhile, back in the field, big third down and 8 for Coastal Carolina. 40% conversions on third down this year. Today, they're 2 for 3, and that's going to make it tougher. That looks like offsides.
False start. Offense.
Sorry, false start.
Number 76. 5-yard
penalty. Left tackle Cameron Stewart. So now it's going to be 3rd and 13. A big opportunity for Georgia Southern because they still have all 3 of their timeouts. You take another look there on the false start.
No question. Sometimes you're not exactly sure who it was, Danny, but that one didn't take the binoculars.
That one clear as day.
All right, this makes it easier for Georgia Southern's defense. 3rd down and 13. Pressure off the edge as they run the option. That one goes nowhere. They fed Holmes. It was Kendall Vildor on the tackle, and a flag comes in from the defensive side of the ball.
It's a great job by Vildor reading that option. Now, last time, when Vildor made a big play, it was a holding penalty on him. Hopefully, it's nothing on the Eagles.
Holding. Offense. Number 76. That penalty is declined. 4th down.
All right, no surprise. Chad Lunsford wants to make him punt.
That's back-to-back bad plays for Cameron Stewart. First a false start, then the holding call.
All right, so a punting situation. Wesley Kennedy back for his second game. We'll stand back from the 20-yard line. And if you're a Georgia Southern fan, this is really good news because you're about to get the ball back with about 4 minutes left in the half. You have three timeouts to get all the way down the field, and you get the ball to begin the second half.
Yeah, this should be textbook execution here for Georgia Southern. This is what you run in practice, these four-minute drills to get towards the end zone and score.
That one nearly blocked, but Prosser gets it away. Kennedy won't get a chance to run that one back as it bounces out of bounds just shy of the 30-yard line. All right, so about 71, 72 yards to go, 3.5 minutes, and all three timeouts for Georgia Southern. That's plenty of time for at least a field goal, if not another touchdown.
And there you see the freshman in Cameron Stewart, frustrated, having a word with one of his teammates. See Jamie Chadwell getting things prepared for his defense as they go back on the field before the first half ends.
He's a great offensive mind, but Coastal Carolina, surprisingly, considering he's such a great offensive mind, their calling card this year has really been their passing defense. Best passing defense in the conference. 7 interceptions this year. Unfortunately for them, Southern not much of a passing team, as you know. All right, 71 yards to go. They'll start the drive from the 29. It's a pitch to Matt LaRoche. Gets about 7 yards as he scampers out of bounds and stops the clock.
And smart move by LaRoche going out of bounds. No need to run the clock and having to waste a timeout early. You want to save those timeouts if you can get closer towards the end zone, maybe in red zone territory where you can talk some things over. It'll be interesting to see what the Eagles do next on 2nd and 2.
And Eagle fans were wondering today, would LaRoche get an increased role with Logan Wright being out? The answer so far, not so much. The actual change has been how much we've seen Wesley Kennedy.
Yeah, Kennedy already 4 carries, 25 yards, and that touchdown earlier in the previous drive.
All right, 2nd down and 2. Big line pressure here from the Shawnts as they feed Kennedy. He scampers past the first 40-yard line. He's got a first down. That'll stop the clock for just a minute. And Danny, they really got all the time they could want. Like we said, all three timeouts and only one left for Coastal.
Now, we've only seen the Eagles throw the ball twice so far in the first half. We'll see if the Eagles try to go for a deep ball here, a big play to put them in position.
They tried that on their very first play of the game from inside the 5-yard line. Our new first down. Pressure off the edge. Blitz coming. Kennedy tries to get to the outside, turns the corner, past midfield, and a first down down to the Coastal 45.
And once again, that's the reason why the Eagles were missing Kennedy those first 4 games. Able to bounce outside again after what looked like the play was going to be dead. Able to get some extra yards, gets out of bounds, gives the Eagles a first down and stops the clock for a moment.
In case you're just joining us today on ESPN3, that's Wesley Kennedy. Scored his 2nd touchdown of the season earlier today. Scored 1 against South Alabama. Missed the first 4 games of the year. But he's been a stud today. Down inside 90 seconds. Southern gets that playoff, or maybe they just called a timeout. We will see, and Chad Lunsford did timeout. Try to burn a timeout right there before the play started.
First
so they didn't get a
of half.
Delay of game.
It'll be a 30-second timeout.
All right, Danny. Well, we were expecting not a ton of passing today. Coastal Carolina has certainly put it in the air more than Georgia Southern, but I'll tell you, those offenses are looking awfully similar. We're seeing more option than usual out of Coastal Carolina today.
Well, I had a feeling that the Shawnte Creek was going to run the ball more considering the weather conditions, a ton of rain. You don't know how that ball is going to flow out of Carpenter's hands or Shywards for that matter. So I think the big story here is just the lack of using C.J. Marable for Coastal Carolina. Yeah, he only had one rushing attempt and he had 2 catches for only 13 yards, but he hasn't been really involved in this offense throughout the first half. I mean, you brought up how he didn't have the best of games last week against Georgia State.
Yeah, averaged about 2 yards a carry against the Panthers. All right, so Georgia Southern now into Coastal territory inside a minute 30 to go in the half. Wirtz is looking downfield. He's going to uncork one into coverage off the hands of Kennedy. No surprise to go back to him. But I kind of thought they'd be looking down the near side at Darian Anderson. Whenever they do play action and throw deep, it's usually Anderson on the receiving end.
Yeah, Anderson caught a lot of deep balls for Georgia Southern here, especially last season. They had a big one against Appalachian State on the Thursday night game on ESPNU. But Wirtz has options. He has weapons that he can throw to downfield.
He's now 1 for 3 on the day through the air. 18-yard completion earlier to Kennedy. They'll feed King, following some good blockers, staying on his feet down to the 32, and he's got a Southern first down. And here come the Eagles, 1:15 to go, and they're on the move.
And you know King has to be happy with his recent performance over the last couple of games. Struggled early.
And they're going to feed him again, but linebackers broke through the line that time. That was Teddy Gallagher for his second tackle.
You got to remember, King transferred to Georgia Southern in January of this year after last season at Oklahoma State, only having 43 rushes and 153 yards.
Down inside 50 seconds, linebackers get through. Short gain, maybe about 2 yards on that play. Georgia Southern may want a timeout.
Timeout, Georgia Southern.
And it looks like they're going to take one.
Second charge timeout. Will be a 30-second.
All right, Danny, so the question is, can you get close enough with a couple more big plays to shoot for the end zone, or is this Tyler Bass time again?
Well, it all depends on what the Eagles do on third down and 8. You saw in the previous plays after J.D. King had a great run, bouncing through a couple of tackles, got halted in the backfield, so... 3rd and 8, you go to your X-Factor players. We saw when the Eagles were in the red zone and scored a touchdown on Wesley Kennedy. So expect Kennedy to get the ball here in some form of fashion.
We saw a big play early on from Malik Murray. Saw a big breakaway from Caleb Hood. And the rest of the big ones have really been from Wesley Kennedy and Shai Wirtz.
Now, we haven't seen Wirtz carry the ball much in the option on this drive.
Not on this drive.
So you could see an option by Wirtz as well. So expect either Shai or Wesley Kennedy.
All right, big 3rd down and 8 for Southern. Linebackers drop back into coverage. Oh, he overthrew Colby Ransom even though he had him open. And Shai Wirtz now 1 for 4 on the day through the air. That's a pass he's usually good for.
Yeah, and that's a pass that you got to make. There was plenty of space for Ransom as well. You could even went for a slant there for about 4 or 5 yards, get the ball to him, and have Ransom do the rest. But overthrew his target. Now you have Tyler Bass coming back out.
All right, this should be north of 45 towards 47 or 48 yards. They're going to call it 48. Pass has been good from outside 40 this year, but that one's blocked. It's rolling back past the 50. Tyler unable to fall on it. Coastal's going to get that ball at the 41-yard line. And now the Chanticleers have a really good chance here with the last 30 seconds before halftime.
It is the big moment for them. Great block field goal by the Chanticleers. You're 31 seconds left on the clock. You have one timeout. And try to go for a passing play up the middle. Try to get your... Try to get close from the field goal range for your kicker.
Let's take a look at the replay.
I mean, it's a sea of bodies just that over
one,
the middle.
That wasn't even a hand at the top of the pile. It looked like they got to that ball before it got very far in the air.
Yeah, like you saw like 3 or 4 Chanticleers just over the middle. Able to block that kick from Bass.
Not a very far field to go. Maybe call it 41 yards here in the next 30 seconds. And they've been better passing. 4 for 4 through the air today, just shy of 60 yards and a touchdown. Now, one of those was that huge deep pass for a touchdown to Isaiah Likely.
Well, keep an eye on Likely. He's on the far side here.
New first down, only one timeout remaining for the Shants as they go to Javon Hightley, their leading receiver on the year. Maybe give him 5 yards. He had a great week last week against Georgia State. 6 catches, 75 yards, and a touchdown. Down inside 20 seconds. Here they go. Gain of 6.
Try to get one more playoff before they bring out the kicker and call a timeout.
Carpenter looking far side. That ball is either incomplete or fumbled at the 40. It's a fumble, and Southern fell on it.
Well, there you see how the rain can impact the ball when being thrown. Carpenter, it looked like it slipped out of his hand.
It was Traver Vleem who fell on it. He's had a couple really good plays at home this season.
So here you see, with that rain, yeah, that ball just slipped out of Carpenter's hands. He went back to throw it.
So in the last minute of play, we saw Shai Wirtz overthrow a man on a pass that he almost always completes. And now we've seen the ball slip loose. Although the cameras aren't picking up just how badly it's been raining, we promise you it's really bad here in Statesboro.
Yeah, and the Eagles are going to go with the right decision here, instead take a knee. But I think they're going to review that previous play.
Timeout. Coastal Carolina.
Instead, Coastal Carolina is going to call a timeout.
Well, this would be a Coastal fan's dream.
Timeout.
Coastal Carolina is going to burn a timeout.
For what reason, I'm not sure. I mean, the Eagles were going to go for the knee and go to the locker room. They have the ball to start the second half.
Couldn't tell you. All right, Danny. Well, we said at the beginning of the game, on the second play of the broadcast for the folks, what kind of game we thought this was going to be. We said close and low scoring, and that's pretty much what we've had in the first half.
Yeah, the rain being a key factor in this game. Georgia Southern able to get a field goal in the first quarter. And we saw a great touchdown pass from Carpenter to Isaiah Likely. The Eagles answer back with a four-yard run by Wesley Kennedy. It was going to be a great opportunity for Coastal to get a field goal to tie this game up, but a ball slipped out of the hands of Carpenter. So now the Eagles are going to go back to that kneeling formation.
All right, and that is the end of the first half. Georgia Southern on top of Coastal Carolina 10-7. First score of the first half was a field goal from Tyler Bass. Then an over-the-top pass from Coastal to Isaiah Likely from Bryce Carpenter to take the lead. And then with a couple minutes left in the second quarter, Georgia Southern punched it in from a couple yards out with Wesley Kennedy. Amy Zimmer has the head coach of Coastal Carolina, Jamie Chadwell.
Coach, after a blocked field goal and then a fumble in the final 30 seconds of the first half, what's the message to the team going into the locker room?
Well, we're playing hard, and obviously this weather is it's tough to play in, but we had a chance there to at least maybe line up for a field goal, and we're screwing up, making too many mistakes. So I like how we're playing, but we got to tighten up some of the things. We've had too many penalties that have hurt us.
How much is this weather affecting play?
Well, I think it affects it a lot. I mean, the quarterback lost the ball right there. It slipped out of his hand. That ball was wet. But it does, you know, it's hard to throw on certain things, and it's been challenging, but they have to do it too, so we got to be better.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Greg.
Thank you, Amy, the bravest member of our broadcast team today by a country mile. At the break, Eagles on top, 10-7 on ESPN3. All right, Betty, ready and back on ESPN3 to get the second half started. Georgia Southern on top of Coastal Carolina. Here's Amy Zimmer with Chad Lunsford at halftime.
Coach, with similar offenses, what is it going to take to pull away here in the second half?
Well, we're going to get the ball right here. It'd be nice to go down, get a great drive, put 7 points on the board, and I think that would help get a great defensive stop, do it again, and that right there will put us ahead by a lot. Okay, I think our offense and defense are playing well right now. There's not many possessions in this ball game, so we got to make sure we make them count.
What kind of challenges is the weather?
I think we're fine. We're built for it. Probably the pass game a little bit. We're not able to grip the ball. You know, we've had several flashes, shots called that we just couldn't hit the deep ball on because we couldn't really grip the ball. So I think that's one of the challenges right now.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Greg, back to you.
All right, thank you, Amy. And you know, Danny, while that is usually how football and math works, if you score two touchdowns and don't give one up, you would be ahead by a lot.
Yeah, well, it's going to be important for Georgia Southern here to score on this opening drive. They did a great job in the first half, as we saw in the first half stats. 32 runs, 161 rushing yards. They continue that momentum.
I can't help but notice that both coaches seem pretty pleased and pretty positive headed into halftime.
Well, I mean, you know the elements that are going on right now, and Jamie Chadwell even knew the way the ball slipped out of Carpenter's hands, the way how wet it is outside, that things like that are going to happen. And he's got to be proud with the way his defense has performed against this spread option for Georgia Southern. It's been a back-and-forth battle throughout the first half. Let's see how both teams answer here in the second.
All right, here's Biscardi to get us started in the second half. This is Kennedy. He's going to let that one bounce out of bounds, and Southern will take it from the 25-yard line. Okay, Danny, what was to like and what was not to like about Southern's offense in the first half?
I mean, the big thing was how Wesley Kennedy and J.D. King was able to move the ball downfield. I mean, the only thing that I didn't really like was the incomplete pass by Shy Wirtz on that final drive to end the first half. It was an open man that he had in Kobe Ransom, and it would have gotten the Eagles downfield to potentially score.
First half MVP Wesley Kennedy?
For now, yes. He was able to get that touchdown to put the Eagles ahead here 10-7.
All right, first play of the second half for Southern. That one gets busted wide open, but somehow J.D. King falls forward past the 30-yard line. That play should have been blown up for a big loss.
And that was close there. I mean, with the Chanta Clears running multiple fronts on defense, it's going to be difficult at some points. They've already made some great stops there in the first.
What do we think about J.D. King's performance in the first half with Logan Wright being out today?
I think it's really good. You know, his 12th carry on the afternoon. He's gotten more settled in, more comfortable, getting first-team reps here over the last few weeks with the absence of Logan Wright.
That last one gave him 12 carries for about 40 yards. Four-down lineman, linebacker blitz coming. They'll run the option. Shy trying to turn the corner. Dives forward to the 35-yard line, and if he didn't pick up the first down, it's going to be inches to go.
That was a great run by Wirtz, and he brought up, and there was another thing that I didn't like from Georgia Southern in the first half. That was the defense in that first series against Coastal Carolina in the first quarter. You got a player down for the Chanticleers because you had the holding penalty by Kendall Villador. You had a targeting call on Kendrick Duncan, and he's out for the game. But the defense has shaped up since then and done a great job.
Well, speaking of defense, this would be unfortunate. This appears to be, for the second time today, Sincere Evans, the redshirt freshman linebacker for Coastal, who was hurt. He had to go out for a couple of plays. He was hurt in the first half, and looks like he's probably okay here, too.
There you see, talking to the training staff. He was able to get up on his own when he was down the first time, and that was pretty severe considering that he was holding his lower right leg. But he's able to get back up. He's concurring with the training staff. He's able to walk off on his own again. Hopefully it's nothing severe.
Yeah, and the rain is really starting to come down here in Statesboro as well. Amy Zimmer has a little bit more on that.
Greg, the rain just continues to come down harder and harder as we continue through this game. Just to give you an idea of the conditions these players are playing with, take a look at this puddle right here. Thankfully, I've got my rain boots on, but the players, they do not. These puddles starting to build up. Also, on the walls of the Paulson Stadium, water is pouring out. And not to mention, too, on both sides of the field, players are constantly being handed towels to dry off their hands and try to keep themselves dry so they can handle the ball better. Greg, back to you.
All right, thank you so much, Jamie. First down and 10 up here in the press box, by the way. Greg Talbot and Danny Wall with you here along for the ride on ESPN3. That was Wesley Kennedy on the run to the 45 for Georgia Southern.
And this rain is just continuing to pour down. It's been like this all day. You had facilities members and the broadcast team, the cameraman here, as early as 8 a.m. this morning. And even then, it was a consistent drizzle, I'm sorry. And there was like a moment or two where the rain stopped, but, you know, right as the game started, it picked back up, and now it's just increasing and increasing as this game rolls on.
They'll say that he was out of bounds at the 41-yard line, so here's second and four. They feed J.D. King to the 44-yard line, probably just 1 yard short, bringing up third down and short. Eagles, by the way, in the first half on third down, 3 for 6, not bad. That's way better than their season average of 25%.
No, they've done a great job on third down conversions here so far tonight. I mean, one of those third down conversions was a touchdown by Kennedy as well. They've done a good job moving the ball.
All right, so they will send King off the field for this third down. So in the backfield, Matt LaRoche and Wesley Kennedy. First and 10. Kennedy tried to go off tackle, and the defense was ready for him. Gain of 2 yards. Kennedy awfully effective in the first half, although he did not lead the Eagles in rushing, still over 50 yards on 7 attempts.
And best believe, with the absence of Logan Wright, Kennedy's going to step in and be that number one and number two guy here for the next couple of games.
Second down and 8. Looks like there's some linebacker pressure off the edge coming here for Coastal, and looks like Southern jumped on the left side of the line.
And maybe a false start on Gerard Leeds.
False start. Offense, number 70.
5-yard foul. Second down.
Well, there you go, Danny.
Eagles lined up in that traditional triple option offense. And Leeds may have flinched there on the snap.
Makes it a little more difficult today, even compared to other days when Southern gets behind their own sticks. This is going to turn into second down and 13. Shy Wirtz is a great arm, as we saw through last year and when he's been back this year, but has had trouble today with effectiveness. He's only 1-for-4. His accuracy has not quite been on point.
And you may see Shy throw the ball maybe 3 or 4 times here in the second half. They don't throw the ball as often.
Malik Murray, the motion man. They feed Kennedy. Gets back maybe to the line of scrimmage, maybe a gain of 1 on that play. So third down and really long coming up. I am surprised that they've really been using Malik Murray in motion and putting him in the backfield. We really have not seen that yet this year.
Yeah, I mean, they're giving a plethora of guys an option to run the football. I mean, Caleb Hood on the end around, Malik Murray on a couple of runs. Matt LaRoche has been the guy that hasn't gotten as many carries as we expected here today.
All right, third down and 11. Eagles spread wide. Kennedy on the draw, and the defense was ready for him. Turns upfield, past midfield, about 2 yards short. So this would be a manageable fourth down for Southern, about 4th and 2, but a flag comes in, it looks like, from the far side at the end of the play.
Could be unsportsmanlike conduct considering how late the flag was thrown, but once again, Kennedy, given the space, able to turn nothing into something, even though he was shy of the first down.
Legal block below the waist. Offense, number 26, blocking back towards the ball. That's a 15-yard foul.
And they'll replay third down and long. That's a bummer for Southern. That was a pretty good run from Kennedy.
That's on Najee Thompson. The sophomore from Bowling Springs will hop off the field.
And I'll tell you, Najee Thompson's been getting a lot more looks these last couple of games. A lot of playing time and a couple of catches as well.
Yeah, you've seen him progress here throughout the season. Although that play, not the best in Thompson, but overall, he's been improving steadily throughout the year for Georgia Southern.
So this is going to turn into what? Third down at about 25 yards. Yeah, third down and 24.
You got 4 wide receivers out. Shy may drop back and pass. Look for the deep man here.
Might be hard to throw with pressure and the rain, though. Shy once again 1-for-4 in the first half through the air. They'll settle for a run to J.D. King. He's going to get past the 35 and bring up fourth down. And this should be time for Anthony Beck.
Well, there's any positive. This is the first time the Eagles are punting here in this game.
I was about to say this is the first time we'll see the South Effingham graduate. He's from right down the road.
And Beck earning that starting position after the suspension of a previous punter for Georgia Southern, missing the first 2 games. Beck coming in and done such a great job against LSU and against Maine and stayed in that starting punter spot.
For folks from the Savannah area, his South Effingham Mustangs went to overtime last night, lost in a really close game to Wayne County. That's a big game around here. That one nearly blocked, but he gets it in the air. That takes it. Shantz bounce back past the 40-yard line. So a short field here to go for Coastal Carolina for their first drive of the second half. They'll get it back next on ESPN3. All right, taking a look at scores from around the Sun Belt today. No big surprises so far.
Yeah, Appalachian State 24-7 lead over Louisiana Monroe. Army Georgia State takes place at 7 p.m. You had 2 games earlier in the week. Troy beating South Alabama, battle for the belt. And also Louisiana defeating Arkansas State. Louisiana, team that beat Georgia Southern last time. The Eagles were at home in prime position to take the West as of right now in the East. It looks like Appalachian State, but you don't know as of yet. Georgia State may try to creep up on them, and if Georgia Southern can get back on a run, they'll give the Mountaineers a run for the money, too.
Man, Army's been in a couple really tight games this year, huh?
I know. Especially the biggest one was against Michigan a few weeks ago. Yep. They're almost able to upset Michigan, send them to overtime. Close win there. Close game there.
A couple of familiar coaches in that game coming up as well. So second down and 11. About 5 minutes into the third quarter here. Eagles had a pretty decent drive and then settled for a punt. As Bryce Carpenter, who's been the main QB today for Coastal Carolina, scrambles for a short gain. In case you're just joining us today, Fred Payton is not playing for Coastal. He is hurt, did not make the trip, so Carpenter is the guy.
And also you brought up that there might be some Georgia Southern fans that are Army fans, because Jeff Munkin was the former head coach for Georgia Southern when they were in the FCS, was the head coach when Georgia Southern beat Florida in 2013.
That's exactly what I was implying. All right, 2-for-4 on third today for Coastal. This is third down and 6. Carpenter's looking for someone downfield, got rid of it, pass incomplete, and he might have been toward the line of scrimmage. Either way, that does bring up fourth down, and really great for Georgia Southern's defense to not let that play develop as it got down the field.
Yeah, and even if Isaiah Likely did make the catch, he did seem short of the first down, so good job by Georgia Southern. And they'll get the ball right back.
All right, they are sending out Miles Prosser to kick this one away. Leslie Kennedy back to receive one around the 15-yard line. A couple really good punts today, by the way, for Miles Prosser. He pinned Southern inside their 5-yard line once.
Had a great bounce in that first punt. Let's see if he can do it again.
Bad snap in the rain. He managed to get rid of that one. Holy cow, and Kennedy's going to call for a fair catch around the 15. That's about as well as that could have gone for the Shunts.
Another case of the rain playing a factor. A bad snap that hit the ground before it got to the punter's hands, but still was able to get it off really well. And if Kennedy would have let that one bounce, it could have gone inside the 5 again.
This is the first time in quite a few years that we have had a consistent, steady rain going through the entire game. I know that it rained a bit during the App State home game on the Thursday night last year. It's been a while since we've had a game quite like this at Paulson.
Yeah, it has definitely been a couple of years since we've had a game like this. But you got to give credit to the Georgia Southern faithful for making their way out to Paulson this afternoon.
Hopefully better weather next weekend. We have another ESPN broadcast coming up a week from today as New Mexico State comes in. Here's Kennedy on the screen play, and that one went absolutely nowhere. Actually a loss.
And for a moment there, Kennedy was trying to find a spot to move downfield, was waiting for the block by his offensive lineman. Just unable to get far.
Even called that one a loss of 2 on the play, so second down and 12. Coastal is playing off the line here. On second and 12. They'll feed Kennedy. Up the middle he goes, and pretty much nothing doing there.
One thing we haven't really talked about for this Eagle offense is that diamond back formation in the back with 3 running backs. They've done that a couple of times. They've even had a couple of plays throughout the season where they've had a straight line, all 3 running backs lining right behind each other behind Shy Wirtz.
They call that the bobsled formation, but speaking of that diamond backfield, we saw that a lot more last year than we have this year.
Yeah.
All right, out of the gun again after the gain of 4. Third down and 8 for Southern. 3-for-7 today. And Coastal drops back into coverage. Wirtz is 2-for-5 passing today. Looks downfield and just rolls out of bounds and gets rid of it, bringing up 4th. That was a busted play.
Yeah, great read by the Chanticleer defense there. You saw a majority of the linebackers and corners drop back. And Shy had plenty of time in the pocket, but couldn't find anyone, ran on the outside and threw it out. So that's going to be a 3-and-out for Georgia Southern.
They have not done very much in terms of 3-and-out today. They've been pretty good on picking up first downs. Although if you're Chad Lunsford, can't be happy with the total offense statistic compared to the overall score. Georgia Southern only winning by 3 as Beck gets this one away, but they are out-tallying Coastal Carolina in terms of total offense, 218 yards to 120 yards. But Coastal Carolina's get it back with pretty good field position on the other side of the break. 10-7 Eagles. Laker Broadcasting. All right, a decent punt on the day from Anthony Beck there for Georgia Southern, and really good field position for Coastal Carolina just on their own side of the 50 here.
I mean, for the most part, throughout the second half, even going back from the second quarter since the Georgia Southern touchdown, things have been halted for both teams.
Carpenter looking downfield again. That one's out of bounds, but a flag thrown from the secondary. So we'll see what the refs have to say. By the way, really glad to see Monquavion Brinson back and playing aggressively, considering last week he was ruled day-to-day.
Yeah, we didn't know what he was going to do.
Holding. Offense. Number 76. That's a 10-yard foul. Repeat. First down.
It's a third penalty on Cameron Stewart here in this game, but we didn't know how much of Monquavion Brinson we were going to see. As you said, he was day-to-day following that South Alabama game 2 weeks ago. But he's hype, he's energized, he's out there contributing. And ever since the last Eagle touchdown, everything's been kind of halted because you had Coastal with a punt, you had the blocked field goal for Georgia Southern, a fumble by Carpenter, and then the first three drives here in the second half all resulting in punts.
Yeah, these defenses have been way more effective in the second half so far as they run the option. This is Mirabal along the near side. Turns up field, gets to the 40, 45, and a flag comes in from the secondary too. Chad is signaling that he thinks this is on Coastal.
I believe that's the first run from Mirabal here in the second half. We haven't seen much of him throughout this game.
There is no foul on the play. It'll be second down.
All right. Second down and a little more than 10 yards to go. They will send Jockeys Hairston off the field. He was pretty effective in the first half. I haven't seen really anything out of him in the second. Bryce Carpenter seemed pretty open and comfortable throwing the ball at the beginning of this game, Danny. He's gotten more conservative as we've gone further in.
Yeah, I mean, as the rain continues to pile on, you don't want to have another mishap where you potentially fumble the ball.
All right, call this second down and 14. Trips to the top of your screen. He will turn and give it off on the draw play. Mirabal turns up field. Defense there to meet him around the 47, 48-yard line, bringing up third down and long.
Mirabal, the junior from Decatur, Georgia, able to break out a couple of tackles. Turned that into about a four-yard gain.
He was Coastal's offensive player of the year last year. Good year this year, over 500 yards, five touchdowns, just not much of an impact last week at State, and not much of an impact today either.
And he did make two catches as well, and he is a good receiver for the Chanticleers too. He has three receiving touchdowns.
One of which against Kansas, and their big pre-conference win. Carpenter rolling. Good spin off defense there. 1 or 2 yards short of the first down, that's hauled in for the first time by Jeremiah Miller. That was his 13th catch of the year.
And a great job by Carpenter to keep that ball in, rolling out on his right, able to throw across his body. Good catch by Miller, even though he will be short by 2 yards. Interesting decision here to see if Coastal's going to go for it.
They go for it a lot. They have gone for it 12 times this year. They've converted 11. So they go for it a lot, and they've only missed once. You got to like their chances here.
Got to have aggressiveness that help them beat Kansas to open up the season.
Well, we might have to wait a second. It looks like they're going to take a quick timeout called by Jamie Chadwell. That's their first.
Timeout. 30 second. Timeout.
All right, Danny, so knowing that Coastal goes for it as much as they do, look at Jamie Chadwell taking a look at his chart. I think he might be drawing something good up.
Yeah, and it's going to be interesting to see who he goes to because, like I said, we haven't seen much of C.J. Mirabal. It's mainly it's been Bryce Carpenter that's been running the ball for the most part for the Chanticleers, 11 carries for 45 yards. So he can keep it himself, do another fake and run up the middle. That's worked a couple of times throughout this game. He's gotten about 7 or 8 yards each time.
And you might be wondering when we're reading off these stats, well, if he's their leading rusher and they've only thrown 7 times, how are they possibly this far into the game? The answer is Southern has had 10 more minutes on time of possession than Coastal Carolina, 25 minutes to 15 minutes. They're going to go for it on 4th down and 2. Carpenter out of the gun. It looks like Coastal jumped on the offensive line.
That could be on Stewart again.
Yeah, I think it's the freshman, Cameron Stewart.
Yeah, that's going to be okay. That's the 4th penalty on Cameron Stewart. He had a false start earlier. He had holding. So now it goes from 4th-and-2 to 4th-and-7. I don't think they're going to go for it. They're going to play it safe and punt.
Now here comes the punt unit. And if you're Georgia Southern, you got to be relieved about that because statistically, again, 11 out of 12 odds were overwhelmingly in favor of the Shawns converting. Kennedy waiting back on the 10-yard line for the kick from Miles Prosser. We've had some slippery punts in the half. Not here, though. Pretty much perfect. Kennedy, fair catch around the 10-yard line, and that'll take us to a break midway through the third quarter on ESPN3. Eagles still on top by 3. Pretty much nothing here in the second half. All right, Chad Lunsford and his Eagles still up by 3 here on ESPN3 midway through the third quarter. Speaking of the Southern coaching staff, we have a pretty funny story for that. Let's go down to Amy Zimmer.
Greg, we have a little bit of a brotherly rivalry happening here for this ball game. Chris Foster, Georgia Southern's running backs coach, is on obviously the Eagles side. And then at Coastal Carolina's side, we have his brother Bryant Foster, the defensive backs coach. And I talked to both of them before the game and asked them, is there a little bit of a rivalry going on here between you guys being able to play one another? And they said, yes, actually, Bryant currently is 1-0 against his brother Chris, and that this is going to be a big deciding factor for them, especially when it comes to those Christmas parties and family gatherings, because there's always a little bit of chippiness there. So it's going to be fun to see which one comes out with the W tonight. But of course, they know that this game is also bigger than themselves, and it's all about these young men. Guys, back to you.
All right, thank you so much, Amy. Shywertz got absolutely lit up on that play. Wes Kennedy picked up the first down, and I'm surprised we don't have a flag coming in on that tackle, because that was absolutely brutal.
It was close to being a horse collar, and you see the staff checking on Kennedy to make sure he's okay, and I think he's going to come off on the field. He seems frustrated there, but he made a big run for Georgia Southern first play, considering that the first two possessions for each team ended in punts.
And we saw Chris Foster there briefly on the sidelines. All right, so 4:15 to go. Turns into a first down for Georgia Southern. Hopefully Shywertz is okay after getting blown up there. And for the second straight play, as LaRoche goes down in the backfield, the Coastal defense is there. Danny, why has Georgia Southern's offense been so much less effective in the third quarter than the first half?
Well, you talk about plays being blown up, and that was a great job by Jalen Walker for Coastal Carolina. You just see the defensive line being able to get through that O-line. We talked about earlier how the O-line trying to get settled in. It's a big change considering changing from last year when you think you had three seniors and you had Brian Miller go down with a season-ending hip injury before the season started. So you're just trying to find the right set of guys to run through here on this O-line.
All right, second down and 11. Wirtz on the option. Kennedy there for him, behind his blockers. About the 37-yard line. Came very close to the first down if he didn't get it. I saw Darian Anderson lined up to the far side at the top of the screen. I would not be surprised if we see the conservatism of this play calling temporarily take a break. I think we might see one deep play here on this drive.
I mean, you see it at least once a game, especially on the first play for Georgia Southern earlier when the game started.
When Darian Anderson is out there, got to be careful. That's all I'm saying. That was lined up to the bottom of the screen. Colby Ransom to the top. Shy 2 for 5 passing today. Back to the ground they go. And pretty much nothing doing there. Slip around to the line of scrimmage for Wes Kennedy.
Kennedy close to a 100-yard rushing day.
He's getting there. He's what now, about 90?
Yeah, close to 90 yards on 13 attempts. Previously had the big 16-yard run to find some open grass for Georgia Southern.
Well, this game started with plenty of offense compared to what we thought we were going to see today, and since late in the second quarter, pretty much nothing. Malik Murray goes in motion on second down. Here's Kennedy breaking loose to the outside. Tripped up past midfield, but a big first down anyway.
And as good as Georgia Southern's been running the ball, the score remains the same, 10-7. It's a lot of big plays in between the 20s, 5-yard lines. No team has been able to really jump ahead. The third quarter has been pretty stagnant.
Chad Lunsford is not going to be happy if the Eagles have to settle for a Tyler Bass field goal here, because if you get three, you're still only up 6 points, and Coastal can take the lead on just one touchdown and a PAT. They would like to score again here with a touchdown, not a field goal.
Right. If the Eagles can hope, they can use the rest of this quarter here to get downfield. They need a touchdown.
Wirtz gets blown up again. Great pitch to Kennedy along the outside. It's up to about the 36 and came very close to the chains. I'll tell you, Shy is getting absolutely lit up on this drive. They got to be careful with that.
Yeah, you definitely have to be careful, considering that he missed a couple of games early. Now, Justin Tomlin, who did start against Maine and against Minnesota, he was solid. I mean,
had a hard time pitching the ball, though, with the option. That's what you got to be careful about. You can let him throw, but...
But the difference is, between Tomlin and Wirtz, is that with Tomlin, you can't open up the playbook as much as you can with Shy Wirtz.
Absolutely true.
And that rain is definitely being a factor as well.
New first down, safety creeping up for Coastal. Expecting the option, they'll get it. Wirtz turns up field. Pretty decent blocking. Past the 30-yard line, and again came awfully close to the first down, maybe second down and one or two.
Well, it's important here as time ticks down, you got room for one more play, and then Wirtz can catch a breather here before the fourth quarter.
So unless we see a big play break here for Southern, we will have seen a scoreless third quarter with a lot of defense. And they will call it second and two. This will likely be the final play of the third quarter.
Traditional triple option.
That ball's on the ground. J.D. King fumbled it. Coastal says they have it inside the 30. And they've got it.
And you heard the oohs and ahs from the fans, and they could tell the ball went out, and that's... You know Chad Lunsford can't be happy with that. I mean, the Eagles were moving greatly down the field, was trying to get on the board and increase their lead, and that doesn't help at all.
Yeah, that was C.J. Brewer, the D-tackle out of Bowdoin, Georgia. Went to Bowdoin High School, who recovered it. So this is exactly what Coastal Carolina wants. And it seems like, if I'm seeing this right, are they getting up on the benches celebrating? And it seems like the Georgia Southern fans feel pretty antagonized over there is what I'm hearing.
Yeah, Coastal Carolina trying to make a statement. I'm not sure exactly what's going on the side.
All right, 20 seconds to go here in the third quarter. That play nearly blown up. Along the outside here goes Mirabal to the 30. Spins off a tackle to the 34. Didn't get to the first down marker, about 5 yards on the play. But if that's the attitude these teams and these fans are going to have, we are going to have a mean, mad fourth quarter.
Previous play is under further review.
Previous play under further review.
You got to give credit to the Georgia Southern fans out there, just painted in ponchos, trying to have a good time. Did you hear about the new name for the Georgia Southern student section?
I did.
Called the Flock.
Yes. The students themselves on Twitter didn't seem to love the name.
Teach his own. I mean, each sport has their designated fan base. I mean, when you go in the Hanner Fieldhouse where Georgia Southern plays their basketball and volleyball games, you got the Hanner Hooligans. So the Flock for
there's
football.
The Hanner Hooligans, the Clements Crazies, and the Flock.
I can't forget the Clements Crazies as well for Georgia Southern
baseball.
So we're
baseball. Just abandoning the alliteration.
Well, what would you call it?
Oh, I don't have any ideas. I have no dog in this fight. I just kind of like the alliteration that basketball and baseball have.
Taking a look at this play. Mirabal able to break one tackle, getting past Raynard Ellis.
I'm not sure I see what the penalty is.
I think it might be right there on Donald Rutledge, leaning in on his head. It could be looking for targeting. I'm not exactly sure, but we'll see what the referees say.
If Georgia Southern sees a second safety toss for targeting, Chad Lunsford would rightfully lose his mind. By the way, in case you're just joining us, Kendrick Duncan Jr., a junior, was sent out in the first half for targeting.
Had both Rutledge and Daryl Baker Jr. going back and forth, starting at strong safety. We'll wait to see what the official call is. CJ Wright having a good time on the sideline.
Which one of the Village People do you think you would go as for Halloween?
I'm not sure, but I'm being told that the officials are looking for for targeting against Coastal Carolina on Shai Wirtz.
I admire our broadcast crew for staying on that shot as long as they did.
Targeting is overturned. There is no foul. Stamp.
Because there is no targeting. It's an interesting review there with 10 seconds to go in the third quarter.
It will be We've had second down.
Quite a few official reviews today.
Yeah. I mean, it's a dogfight. This is a war here between the Eagles and Chanticleers. I mean, you got to understand how antsy the Eagles had to be after having 16 days rest in between games.
This game is mean off of I-16. Final play of the third quarter here. Carpenter out of the gun. That play blown up in the backfield. Georgia Southern ends the third quarter with a Ty Phillips tackle for loss. We're going to the fourth. Eagles by three. This finish is going to be good. Missed. Unfortunately, the weirdest thing that I have seen at Paulson Stadium in years. We saw essentially when the stadium started playing the song Mo Bamba, a hype dance-off between the two teams. I didn't think I heard any smack talking, but these referees are giving penalties to every single player on each roster, which means that we're going to see about five or six ejections because a couple of these guys already have personal fouls.
I don't like that. What are we playing football here?
So Jay Bowdry is gone.
And two players for Coastal Carolina is gone too. I love that intensity.
Okay.
Unsportsmanlike
conduct. They're just having fun.
Look, this is.
They're dancing.
This is what you want to see. Is a three-point ball game entering the fourth quarter. Both teams getting hyped. Both teams need a win in the Sun Belt Conference. What are we doing here? Football or not? This is.
Little Mo Bamba never hurt anyone. Am I right?
Yeah. This is the game that every football player should love because you're out here playing in the rain. You're getting dirty, getting wet.
So a couple players gone for each team. First among equals for Coastal Carolina, Tequil Holmes, one of their running backs out of Charleston.
And then also Seth Harrell, the redshirt sophomore offensive lineman, he's out for the game as well.
So Georgia Southern now has lost both of their safeties, by the way, because Kendrick Duncan was ejected for targeting in the first half.
I don't know exactly what's going on here, but I like the intensity I'm seeing from both teams.
Ejected for a little dance-off. That's a bummer. That one might end up on SportsCenter a little bit later. That pass is off the hands of Keon Tyler. Was it incomplete? Incomplete, not fumbled. Luckily for Coastal Carolina to start the fourth quarter.
I'll tell you what, the fans here at Paulson are here for a treat. Here you see the pass wobbled a little bit, and it results in incomplete. Here you see the puddles coming up on the field. This is a game as a fan that you get to say, I was there. Similar to what Georgia Southern fans from 30 years ago saying, I was there at the Hugo Bowl.
I feel like we got to give these students who are here trophies for this one. What a great atmosphere we've got going after that dance-off.
Well, you know how involved Chad Lunsford is.
At the previous spot, fourth down.
You know how involved Chad Lunsford is with the students at this university. So, best believe he's going to be hyped up and enjoy and give thanks to the fans that made their way out here this afternoon.
All right, Prosser to kick. Wesley Kennedy back at the Southern 30. We've had some wet snaps today, and a flag flies in from the near side as well. That one bounces out of bounds. And Danny, we're going to have another flag. We got some active referees here in the second half.
This is going to be fun to watch here in the fourth. That's all I can really say. I mean, that moment with both teams.
I've never seen anything like that.
That got me hyped during the break.
That's not very hard, Danny. You're a hype guy. Now, that is the kids, I would believe, though. I think the kids would call that lit.
Oh, absolutely. That's going to be on the receiving team.
Offside. Kicking team. 5-yard penalty. Previous spot. Replay. Fourth down.
All right, and we'll do it again.
Receiving team.
There we go.
A Well, there has been plenty of defense so far in the second half. In case you're just joining us, it was 10-7 at halftime and almost nothing major of note in the third quarter.
Yeah, I mean, you look at the drives in the third quarter for both teams. Right, the first four drives holding the punt, the last one with a fumble.
Coastal looks like they're going to go for it here on fourth down. They're 11 for 12 this year on fourth. So statistically, it's into Sean's favor. Carpenter out of the gun. Feet up the middle to Mirable. Got to the 39, shoved backwards. The question is, did he get there on forward progress?
They might bring the chains out to see.
That one's going to be close. The chains are just past the 38-yard line. It looks like he got it by about half a yard. He got it by about half a yard.
So let's take a little look here. Forward motion.
Good push.
Got the first down.
All right, so here comes Coastal. We've had a lot happen in the first 40 seconds of the fourth quarter.
This has been fun. This has been absolutely fun.
All right, short gain on the play. That was Hairston, his first carry of the fourth quarter. Really, it's been C.J. Mirable on the ground, or really it's been Carpenter keeping it pretty much all the way. Only a couple handoffs to Hairston.
Yeah, I mean, we're starting to see more of Hairston and Mirable here as we get to the fourth quarter. I think you should give it to him more. You just saw that previous play when they ran up the middle. They should probably just bounce outside and see if they can get some yards out there.
All right, they're going to call that a gain of two on the play. Second down and eight. Coastal Woods settle for three on this drive. Massimo Biscardi, their kicker, is 6 foot. By Mirable, he came out of the backfield and got to the 49. Looks like he picked up the first down.
You got to remember as well.
And if he didn't, he's very close.
This is the second time that Coastal Carolina has played Georgia Southern in Statesboro. The first time
long
was
time
back
ago.
In 2006.
Yeah.
This is the third time these two teams have met in the Sun Belt Conference. And Georgia Southern leads the overall series.
1 yard to go. They're saying he got shoved out of bounds, and then his knee went down. So third and one. Good snap. This is Hairston. Falls forward, past midfield, and he's got the first down. This is the best second half drive I think we've seen for Coastal Carolina, just in terms of their plays going smoothly.
Yeah, and you know for Georgia Southern, man, you know how long they can keep the ball going and how much time they can run off the clock.
You
for
bet.
Coastal Carolina, they're trying to take their time here, take some minutes off the clock, put the pressure on Georgia Southern if you can move down the field, either tie it up or jump ahead with a touchdown.
And you can hear in our stadium microphones here at Paulson Stadium that the rain continues to fall. You might not be seeing it on the screen, but it is still pouring here. Mirable in motion, and here come the whistles.
Standing flags, could be a timeout.
Previous play is under further review.
Is that another review?
Been a long 3 minutes at the beginning of this fourth quarter, huh? And that's
for sure.
A good camera angle. You can see that the rain continues to pour. It has not stopped since we started.
So let's see exactly what the officials are reviewing here.
Hairston clearly fell forward past the 50. He got the first down. So maybe they're looking for a penalty?
Either that or just to confirm that it is a first down for Coastal Carolina. You see Scott Sloan, defensive coordinator, having words with Rashad Berg. Gus the Eagle having some fun. So this is what I like to see. You like to see fans making the best out of a bad situation. I mean,
yeah, but I want to see him and the players dancing to Mo Bamba. That's what I want to see. Am I wrong?
You saw CJ Wright having fun. I mean, this is a fun atmosphere.
That's like, the thing. Yeah.
Like you, when it's raining like this and you're playing a football game, you almost go back to when you were in Little League. Just going out there and playing in the elements and having just a good time.
Brandon Cross, the cornerback, you see him doing a little cha-cha slide there, number 14.
See, I like this. This is everyone having fun.
Careful, don't slip in the rain when you crisscross.
Oh, yeah, that would be drastic. So himself, CJ Wright.
See, you can see Rashad Bird there, defensive captain. Chris Harris. Love this.
It'll be interesting to see which team slides to a victory in the Sun Belt Conference. Georgia Southern 1-1, Coastal Carolina 0-2. Coastal took on two tough teams in App State and Georgia State, and the officials may have a decision here.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
And they were checking to see just to make sure it was a first down for Coastal Carolina.
Seemed pretty evident from up here in the broadcast booth, but then again, that's why we have the bird's eye view. And the students, as you can hear, disagree, as they are wont to do. The flock. And here comes Carpenter. New first down. And the folks here in the rain are getting loud at Paulson. Lane Ecton brings pressure off the edge. Play action. Carpenter steps up. Taken down for a short gain, maybe three, and it could have been a lot more.
And once again, for Georgia Southern, Randy Wade Jr.
He's had a good game.
He has had a good game today.
But a flag in as well. More raffering.
Offense, number 63. The 10-yard penalty.
That's going to be on the right guard, Trey Carter.
I have been wondering, with the rain coming down the way it is, must be harder to get a grip and block your defensive lineman if you're an O-lineman. I guess I'm not surprised that some have resorted to holding.
I mean, you heard Andy Zimmer, a Salah reporter, talk about it, how on the sidelines there's towels being passed around to dry off the hands, dry off the football as well, trying to maintain the best level you can play.
All right, so after the penalty, first down and 20. They're on their own 40. They have to get to the Eagle 40. Waiting for all 22 to get on the field. This is Shadell Bell going in motion, the Clemson transfer. Carpenter steps up and Lane Ecton takes him down for a sack and a loss of 5 yards. A senior out of Irmo, South Carolina, getting it done. Second down and 25.
That's his first sack this season, and a big one coming at a crucial point. And he was able to bounce off the edge outside and just lay out Carpenter.
Was that even?
I don't think anyone was blocking
him. I think it was pure unblocked. I'm not even sure he bounced off the edge. Second down and 25. They have to get to the Southern 40. Here comes pressure on Carpenter. He dumps it off. That one looked like it was hauled in by Keon Tyler, and it was. Not much of a gain on that play, and the tackle in there, of course, Raynard Ellis. He's been everywhere.
Yeah, I think that that pre-fourth quarter, I wouldn't even say an altercation.
That was just a dance party, man.
Whatever it was, it definitely hyped up this defense here. I mean, first you had the sack, then a big tackle by Ellis. Now it's third and long, 22 yards to go for the Chanticleers.
Only three men coming for Southern, and they still get to him. That one hauled in by Tyler for the second straight play on his feet to the 50, and he's still 10 yards short.
Well, that time he was able to get to the line of scrimmage, but nonetheless, it's going to be fourth down and 10. Coastal's going to have to punt here. Plenty of time for Georgia Southern. And more than likely, we'll need to go the length of the field.
And as we now dip down inside the 10-minute mark, here's the thing. If you're Georgia Southern, you have beaten Coastal Carolina in terms of time of possession by about 10 minutes so far in this game. You might not even need to score here. You might need to just eat as much time off the clock as you possibly can, as they'll get good field position on the other side of this break, as that's a touchback. Eagles still up 10-7 at the rainiest little stadium in America. All right, Dan, we just had a whistle and a foul right before the commercial break.
Yeah, so we'll see if...
Referees didn't quite give us an explanation over the loudspeakers quite yet, but this looks like it was a penalty.
It was a penalty. It was a personal foul
on Georgia Southern. So Coastal keeps the ball, actually, and gets it at the Southern 35.
Well, that changes everything now. Coastal's still alive here.
All right, so the feed goes to Hairston. He falls forward for a short gain on the play before the defensive line shoves him back around the 35. So it was going to be, if you're Southern fans, hopefully a long drive that took you down inside 5 minutes. All of a sudden, Coastal is nearly in field goal range even in this weather.
Yeah, and that's got to hurt for the Eagle defense because they did such a great job limiting Coastal Carolina, making it fourth down and 10, and then a 15-yard penalty to keep the drive going for the Chanticleer. That's got to hurt the Eagles.
All right, second down and 8. Three receivers to the near side. Sending Tyler in motion. Carpenter keeper. Really good read by the defense. Only falls forward to the 31. That's going to be third down and 5 or third down and 6. And Carpenter still very efficient today. 9 for 11 passing for Coastal Carolina.
It'll be interesting to see if he decides to throw here on 3rd and 7, because if you're Coastal Carolina, you can always go for the field goal to tie it up if you don't get the third down.
Yeah, Coastal 3 for 9 today on third down. That's below their season average of 40%. Spread wide for Carpenter. Don't forget, both Eagle safeties have been ejected. Here comes pressure, dumps it off. He's got Mirabal. And he's not going to get there. Needed to get to the 25, and he comes up short. Okay, so likely the tying attempt field goal coming up here on fourth down.
Yeah, this is going to be big for Coastal Carolina. I mean, Massimo Biscardi is 8 of 11 in field goal attempts. And the 3 that he missed were early in the season, 1 against Eastern Michigan and 2 against Kansas, from 31 and 27. So all 3 of his misses have been 35 and in, but this is a 45-yard attempt.
It is raining
outside.
It is raining. It is windy. There's a tropical storm in the area. Can Biscardi tie this game? Did it have the distance? Yes. That's our first score since the second quarter. We got ourselves a tie game with 7.5 to play in Statesboro. Quick break and back after this. Well, the Coastal Carolina field goal gives us our first offense since the end of the second quarter. And for more on the offense, let's go down to the bravest member of our broadcast team today. Here's Amy Zimmer.
Thanks, Greg. Coming into this matchup, both coaches admitted to having very similar offenses, especially when it comes to the run game. Now, of course, the weather today providing a lot more challenges than just the teams itself. As you can see with me, I'm completely drenched and dripping. So just imagine being a player on the field trying to play through this. But Georgia Southern also had to try to prepare for 2 quarterbacks. But with Coastal Carolina's quarterback Peyton being out, that kind of let up the ease for them, now just having to focus on 1 quarterback. As for Georgia Southern, Coastal Carolina said they have to be able to fill in the gaps. If they let Shy Wirtz get anywhere out, then he can make a run for it. So defense is both stepping up big time in this game as well. Greg, back to you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Amy. I hope you didn't have the over in this game, everybody.
I got to say, Amy's a trooper. Be standing out there as long as she has, and this rain has been piling on. I mean, her along with the Georgia Southern fans that came out here to Paulson Stadium, I mean, hats off to you. And sticking the entire way, too.
Yeah, we're up here with a fire roaring in the press box and the robes of the finest silk. Pipes going and everything. 7.5 to go. 28-yard line for Southern. This is a big drive. They'll feed Kennedy. Picks up about 5 yards on the play, and that's all they need.
And this could be very well the last drive of the game, because we've talked about multiple times how much clock the Eagles can run off. 7 minutes is more than enough to go down the field, set things up for a Tyler Bass field goal, or try and go for the touchdown.
We've been saying all day that Georgia Southern wanted to stop relying so much on Tyler Bass when it comes to scoring situations, but in a conference game like this, especially a division game, a win is a win, and I'm sure Chad Lunsford would be more than happy to let Tyler Bass be the hero again. Second down and 5. Run the option. Kennedy again. Up toward the 40. Southern wants a late hit, but they're not going to get it.
And I think for both teams, they'll look back at this game as the turning point at the season, because a win for Georgia Southern puts them at 3-3. A win for Coastal Carolina will give them their first conference win of the season.
That's exactly right. They'll give him the first down. They'll say he got there by about a yard, so a new first and 10. They've got to get to the 48. That's Matt LaRoche in the backfield now. He's at a limited role today. And they'll give it to Speedy. Bounces past the 40 toward the 42. And as if there were any question about it, Danny, obviously Southern wasn't going to go out there as actually there was King on the run. We knew they weren't going to come out there and pass for 15 yards with about 7 minutes. Georgia Southern can easily eat 7 minutes and get in field goal range.
Yeah, I think there's going to go running plays all throughout the rest of this fourth quarter. And Georgia Southern has all three of their timeouts. Coastal Carolina with a two. So there's plenty of time for the Eagles to move downfield.
Coastal Carolina leads the Sun Belt Conference in passing defense, but that was never going to be much of an impact today against a team that only passes about five times a game. There's that diamond backfield on second and six. That's King, and he's wrapped up for a loss. This is a big-time third down now for Coastal Carolina on defense.
Four-man rush for DeShonta Clears and Sterling Johnson, the redshirt senior out of Clayton, North Carolina, making the tackle. I mean, you got to give props to the Coastal Carolina defensive line.
Yeah, by the way, we haven't had much of a chance to talk about this. Johnson, one of two graduate transfers from Clemson.
So being a part of a program that went to a couple national championships.
Won a couple
as well. So bringing that championship mentality to Conway.
All right, third down and seven. This is a big one for Southern as the rain falls. Option, they're going to pitch to Kennedy. He's got a man to beat. Taken down at the 43. He didn't get there. Gain of 2 yards. And gosh, this feels like punting situation.
They might have to.
You can't give it to Coastal just in case at your own 40.
I mean, once again, Coastal, for a great job of reading the option. Mallory Claiborne, the redshirt senior, on the tackle. And yeah, they're going to bring out the punt team with less than 5 minutes to go and counting.
We've seen a couple slippery punts today. If there is any to make sure that gets into the hands of Anthony Beck, this is the one.
Yeah, you got to have a good snap here.
Only the third punt of the day for him. This is Tyler back to receive at the 15. Got rid of that one under pressure. Tyler back at the 7 or 8 yard line. Really good kick for Anthony Beck. All right, that's going to take us to a break. Coastal Carolina gets it inside their own 20. Tie game with 4 to go. All right, well, today has not been an easy game for the Shawns, but their next couple don't get any easier, Danny. Look at that.
Yeah, it's not going to be easy for the Shawns to clear. They will have 2 weeks to prepare for Troy. It's pretty much facing the entire Western Division. Troy, Louisiana, Arkansas State, UO Monroe, and then finishing it off against Texas State.
All right, Coastal, if they want to win this game with a field goal or a touchdown in the next 4:15, has to go 91 yards. Bryce Carpenter, their QB, has not been their main guy this year. That's been Fred Payton. Can Carpenter get it done? Back to the line of scrimmage. Tackle by Ellis. Second down.
Troy in the East, I'm sorry, but still after Troy, you know, you're dealing with all the Western Division of the Sun Belt.
So no easy feed.
It's going to be interesting to see here how Coastal Carolina can move down the field with less than 4 minutes to go. We could potentially see another overtime game, second in a row for Georgia Southern.
Yeah, in case you weren't watching that one in Mobile, Georgia Southern scored with about 15 seconds left to send it to OT. Probably should have lost in the first OT and pulled it out in the second. Gain of one on the play, second down and 9. Mirabal in the backfield. Carpenter out of the gun, looking towards Mirabal. Now the other way, and down he goes! Dylan Springer springs into the backfield for the sack on second down.
And that's a big-time sack by Springer, the redshirt sophomore from Midland, Texas. There you see, Carpenter didn't have any time at all. I mean, you saw all three defensive linemen burst through to
get
the sack.
How did they get there with three?
I'm not exactly sure. You saw Ty Phillips go down. He would have been the first one there. Springer able to work his way past the offensive lineman.
All right, Coastal below their season average mark of 40% on third. They're 30% today, and down he goes again. It's Raymond Johnson this time. Fourth down coming up. What a stop by the Southern defensive front. Back-to-back sacks.
Victor Cabral has got to be jumping up and down on the sideline. The defensive line coach for the Eagles. Two back-to-back big sacks by his linemen. What a spear by Johnson.
And I'll tell you, the linebackers have been the big studs today, making tackles when it comes to plays 1 or 2 yards by the line of scrimmage. These defensive linemen earned their scholarships a couple times over just on that series.
Absolutely.
All right, one more quick break here on ESPN3. Tie game, fourth down, and probably a punt coming up. All right, Eagles hoping for a win here these next couple minutes, Danny, but they're back next week.
Yeah, non-conference game against New Mexico State in a short week as they head to Boone against Appalachian State on Halloween. Another road matchup against Troy, back home against Louisiana Monroe, and on the road at Arkansas State, and they end the season against Georgia State.
Look all right, fourth down, punt situation here. Prosser's just going to try to get this one out of the end zone. And he does, but that's not a very far kick. Wesley Kennedy back around midfield. He's able to hold on to it. They lost some yardage there. So about 51 yards to go for Southern if they need a touchdown. But this is really good field position, and you don't need to go that much farther to get in range for Tyler Bass.
Yeah, great time on the clock, too. 2.5 minutes to play. That's plenty of time for Georgia Southern. So let's get 15, 20 yards if they can hold the ball for that long. If they can get down the field and hold on to the ball for at least 1.5 minutes. But this should be the final possession here.
Tyler Bass has hit from over 50 a couple of times. So really, if you're Southern, you'll need to get that ball to around the 35. 2.5 to go. And us.
Oh, no.
Wow, what a jailbreak there. That was Mallory Claiborne bringing him down. Great. And a loss on the play. Nothing for Kennedy.
A great tackle by Claiborne. I was going to say, on Tyler Bass's Twitter earlier this week, he was taking field goals from about 62 yards deep. So he has the leg if he has to take it from that far.
At last week's Georgia game, UGA did not let Rodrigo Blankenship kick one from 55, and Chad Lunsford tweeted, that's Tyler Bass range.
Well, we'll see if Bass hit the field goal from that deep here.
Second and 14, Wirtz to Kennedy. Upended for a loss, back-to-back plays. What a couple of plays for both of these defenses. That was the CB Jordan Morris.
Second half has been all defense from both teams. I mean,
yeah, in case you're just joining us, we have seen 3 combined points in the second half.
You saw Kennedy try to jump over Morris, but that didn't work out.
Coastal Carolina.
And Coastal's going to call a timeout here. Great opportunity for a timeout.
It'll be a 30-second timeout. Please set the game to 150, 150, please.
So they're going to put 1:50 on the clock.
Well, Georgia Southern had all the momentum in the world, but now they've lost a lot of ground on those last couple of plays, and it's looking more and more like we might be headed to OT for Georgia Southern for the second consecutive game. So let's take the folks through this.
Yeah, and it's going to be interesting to see. Each team gets one possession at 25-yard line, and the other team will get an opportunity after the first team goes on possession. And you must go for a 2-point conversion starting in 3 overtime. They Dallas Tech in 7 overtimes.
That was awesome.
It was awesome, but because of, you know, trying to decide a winner, now you have to go for 2 starting at the 3rd overtime.
3rd down and 18. Will Southern go for it deep, or will they settle for a short run? They're going to let Wirtz uncork one. Over the middle, into coverage. That looks like that was P.I., and it is. K.J. Johnson, the freshman safety, was standing up at the end of that. And it was 3rd down and 18 for Southern. That's only a 15-yard penalty. It would be 4th and 3.
Pass interference. Defense, number 10. The 15-yard penalty. Previous spot. It'll be a first down.
If you're Chad Lund. Oh,
well, you
on the previous
spot. You got to remember, the flag is thrown. The ball is placed at where the flag is thrown plus 15
that's
yards.
That's the first down. That's right. Oh, gosh. That's a heartbreaker for Coastal.
Alex Spillum, the redshirt sophomore from Minnesota.
That's a heartbreaker for them.
So let's see where this ball is going to be placed. Now, I think you had it right the first time, Greg.
I think I did.
I think it says fifth. I think it says automatic first down.
It's only
with the 15 yard.
That's correct. That's what I thought. Okay, so the ball's going to go to the 43. That's what I thought.
NFL rules there.
I think so. All right, so they do get a new first down. They're going to take this ball from the 43.
Yeah, nonetheless, great field position for Georgia Southern to keep this drive alive.
All right, so a big second chance here for the Eagles. Darian Anderson split to the near side. There is a safety to that side of the field. We're getting close to Tyler Bass range. Here's Kennedy. Now they are pretty close to Tyler Bass range inside the 40. This would be a 57-yarder. They could really use another 5 yards.
I think they'll get it. I mean, they'll have at least two plays to do so. Be interesting to see who they give the ball to. I mean, great run by Kennedy. Was able to find the open hole. Great blocking by the O-line. We've seen J.D. King get a couple of yards per carry, about 4 or 5 max.
Second and 5. Pressure coming off the edge here. And they'll bring it. J.D. King up the middle. Tries to get between the hashes. Short gain. Maybe 2 yards. This is going to be a crucial third down. In Georgia Southern today, 3 for 9 on third down. That's better than their mark this year.
So here's what's going to happen. It's going to be third down. They're going to let the clock wind down, try to go for one more running play. The Eagles will call a timeout. Coastal Carolina has one timeout left. They'll try to ice Tyler Bass if they can.
Well, two tight ends set coming here. Both Emery McKenzie and Cam Brown coming in. So two tight ends. Not a surprise. They want blockers.
Yeah, third and 4. They may go up the middle.
That's King flanking Wirtz. I'm surprised there wasn't some kind of flag called on that play. Kids were jumping on both sides. Falls forward, 37. I don't think he got there.
So now you got to pay attention here. 15 seconds left, and I believe.
Timeout. Coastal Carolina.
Yeah, Coastal Carolina instead using their final timeout there.
30 seconds. Timeout.
All right, so Coastal wants to burn their timeout. It's fourth down and 2. 15 seconds. It looks like they're marking this ball at the 36-yard line. So this would be about 52 for Tyler Bass.
We hit a 37-yarder to win the game against South Alabama. He was the hero then in Mobile. And more than likely will be the hero here in the Statesboro in what has been a complete rainy day here in the Statesboro. Just the tropical storm making its way up. It's been raining all day, stopped a little bit, then picked back up and continued to pick up here throughout this game.
Yeah, so Danny, a couple things happen here if Tyler Bass hits this kick. In all likelihood, seals this win for Georgia Southern, gets them back to 500 on the year after a tough 2-3 start as well. All right, here comes Tyler Bass. He was the hero in the bowl game last year. He was the hero last week at South Alabama in overtime. They're going to call this a 53-yarder from the left hash. And he missed it left. How often do you see that from Tyler Bass? Almost never. And that one didn't look like that was weather or wind. He might have just gotten the wrong side of that ball.
I mean, initially it looked like it was going, but it tailed left. It started like it was going to go right, but it hooked, yeah.
And it hooked pretty bad.
He missed a few weeks ago.
He is so hard on himself when he misses two. He really considers himself, and rightfully so, pretty automatic a lot of the time. And it looks like Coastal here, with 9 seconds left, is going to be safe, probably go down. They will. And to overtime we go. For the second straight week for the Georgia Southern football team.
Yep. They won in double overtime 2 weeks ago. Let's see if they can do it again here tonight.
All right. We'll take a quick break here on ESPN3. We have OT in Statesboro, 10-10, Coastal and Southern, and the Sun Belt Conference. All right, there's Jamie Chadwell. His players love playing for him at Coastal Carolina. But on the other sideline, you, of course, have Chad Lunsford and Danny, he is no stranger to overtime these last couple weeks with this team.
Yeah, they went to overtime 2 weeks ago. Georgia Southern overall 8-6 in overtime. And this is the first time since 2008 in which the Eagles played more than two overtime games. In that 2008 season, they played four games in overtime. One of them going to triple overtime against the Citadel.
Southern has won. Got to imagine they want to go second. But we'll see.
Georgia Southern has won the toss and elected to go on defense.
And Danny, no surprise, in college overtime, if you win the coin toss, you want to go on defense because then you know, based on what Coastal Carolina does, what you need.
Yeah, you know what you need to do. And the way this defense has played in the final possession, you know, they did so well at defensive line. And there you see the rules again. So Coastal's going to go first. And Georgia Southern will go second. And they'll know if they need to go for a field goal, a touchdown, or just depending on what Coastal does.
Tyler Bass was not happy with himself as he walked off the field there a minute ago.
Right, but here's the thing that Chad Lunsford talked to us about leading up to this game about Tyler Bass. The last kick doesn't define the next kick, so best believe that Tyler Bass is going to be just fine. You know, he's going to get another opportunity out there. It happened against South Alabama where he missed the first field goal in the
That's
first
true.
Overtime, but redeemed himself in the second overtime.
Number four.
All right, so 25-yard field, no clock. And here comes Coastal Carolina to start overtime here in the Sun Belt Conference. That's Bryce Carpenter. In case you're just joining us, Fred Payton, their normal QB1, not playing this week. Carpenter play action, steps up and runs. Down toward the 15, gain of about 8 yards.
Al, the first time we saw Carpenter run up the middle in quite some time. Did it a lot in the first quarter. Smart move there to get the defensive backs going back for the pass.
He really ran a lot more in the first half than the second half, but part of it is that because Georgia Southern's defensive line was breaking in a lot in the second half.
Yeah, it's been a defensive second half for sure. And we'll see how that carries over into overtime.
We'll give him a 7, 2nd and 3. This is Hairston still on his feet inside the 10. Big saving tackle that time by Donald Rutledge.
Ninth carry for Harrison. And now a fresh set of downs for Coastal Carolina. They're going to try and take it into the end zone. This is where the defensive line needs to step up. They want to make a stop for Georgia Southern.
The rain seems to have let up temporarily here, too, for the first time today. That's interesting.
See how that plays out here on this drive.
That's Mirable in the slot. Got to watch for him. They'll put him in motion. Carpenter keeps. Couple of missed tackles. He falls down to the one or the two. Really good QB keeper on play action.
Once again, another good run up the middle from Carpenter. Definitely showing off his legs here in the first overtime period.
So second and goal from, we'll call it the 2 yard line. And that's Rashad Byrd, the defensive captain, the linebacker. That would be a potentially really bad loss.
Yeah, he's definitely one of the leaders on this Georgia Southern defense. The team leader in tackles. You see on his jersey, one of the captains.
Well, the Georgia Southern defensive line had an unbelievable series that concluded in two back-to-back sacks that helped give them a chance and stop Coastal Carolina. They could use another big couple of plays here from that D-line. Second and goal from the two. Coastal trying to go ahead in OT. That's Hairston in the backfield. And they'll feed him. Stopped at the one. First one in there was Lane Ecton. A couple of big tackles for him in the second half.
Yeah, and also It's third down and one, just shy of the end zone. This is a big time opportunity for Georgia Southern. And you wonder if Coastal is going to give the handoff to Harrison, or if Carpenter keeps himself.
That's Hiley and Miller split as receivers. That's Hairston on the ground. He was stopped at the one-yard line. Rashad Byrd and C.J. Wright. First ones in there.
And C.J. Wright making up for that penalty that he had on fourth down and 10. That resulted in a 15-yard penalty that kept the drive going for Coastal Carolina, resulting in that field goal. Now if you're Coastal, it's fourth down and two. Do you go for the field goal and play it safe, or do you try to go to the end zone for a touchdown?
Well, they just stopped you twice inside the two.
We can always bounce outside, and you see Coastal taking their time to trying to figure out what they want to do, and Chadwell is going to call a timeout.
Well, I'll tell you, they've given up a couple plays to let him inside the five-yard line, but when their backs are against the wall today, and especially the last couple of minutes, that Georgia Southern defensive line has come through when it was necessary.
Yeah, this is gonna be interesting to see, because we don't know what's going to happen. You can honestly go either way. You can play conservatively and go for the field goal, or be aggressive and put the pressure on Georgia Southern going for the touchdown.
Now, I know it's apples to oranges, but Coastal Carolina, like we said earlier in this game, has been really aggressive on fourth down this year. Entering this game, they were 11 for 12 going for it on fourth. Now, overtime does not factor into that, but they would go for it a lot entering this game through their first couple of games.
Yeah, and you got to use that same intensity that you used to beat Kansas earlier in the year if you want to get back on track. And as we hear some music being played, the same music that hyped these teams up entering the fourth quarter.
All right, that's Carpenter. Jamie Chadwell is going to send his offense back out and go for the touchdown. And trust their defense on the either end no matter what. That's a Mirabal in the backfield. He's only got 17 yards rushing today. For the lead, Carpenter. He got over the line. Coastal scores. And the Shawnts are into the lead, 16-10 in OT.
The field is a touchdown.
And we talked about Georgia Southern's overtime record throughout their history. For Coastal Carolina, this is their 11th overtime game. They're 6-4 already, but they're 5-2 in overtime games on the road.
All right, here's Massimo Biscardi. And Paulson Stadium went from loud to hearing a pin drop in a matter of seconds.
The previous play is under further review.
I just want to make sure that it is a touchdown. That's the right thing to do. Fourth down and two.
Couldn't hurt to look at it.
Of course.
We'll take a look.
And going back to Coastal's overtime record, their last overtime game was back in 2016. You see there,
firm touchdown,
and didn't take long for the officials to confirm it's a touchdown.
All right, so here's Biscardi for the PAT to make it a 7-point game. That one sneaks through.
So, Greg, you said that the Eagles rely too much on Tyler Bass. Well, now they can't.
The coaches said that, not me.
Well, yes, that is true. The coaches said they rely on Tyler Bass too much.
Not me. I like Tyler Bass.
But you brought it up. But in this situation, they can't rely on Tyler Bass. They have to rely on this offense. And we talked about the struggles that they've had in the red zone. And now they have to get in the end zone if they want to keep this game going, or else it's over.
Yeah, entering this game, Georgia Southern was not great on red zone trips. They'd only scored 6 touchdowns on 17 red zone trips this year entering this game. And there's Tyler Bass. Only way they're going to use him is if he needs a PAT, if you're a Southern fan, hopefully. From the 25, here comes Southern. They need a touchdown and a PAT to send it to double OT, or maybe a 2-point conversion. J.D. King, gain of 2 or 3 yards. We said at the top of the broadcast that he needed to have a really big day in replacement, really, of Logan Wright. Almost 20 carries, 60 yards, no touchdowns, 3.5 yards a carry.
Yeah, it's mainly been Wesley Kennedy that's had the better running night for Georgia Southern. 22 carries, 118 yards, and the only Eagle touchdown.
Here comes pressure from the linebackers. Second down and 7. It's King falling forward to the 20. This is going to be a big third down and 5.
So now you have to decide. Do you go to King again? Do you go to Wesley Kennedy? Do you have Shy keep it with the option? A lot of decisions the Eagles need to make here.
Southern has outgained Coastal by about 100 yards on offense today. Can they get 5 on third down? Kennedy in motion. Wirtz will go to Kennedy, but there's someone there to block him, and it's incomplete. Jordan Morris, the freshman corner, with the open field breakup. And you got to go for it.
I have no choice, but what do? Do you try to pass it and try to go for that? That fade route like he tried to go to for Kennedy, or do you run it?
Well, here comes Cam Brown, a tight end. They really haven't thrown to him much this year, only 2 catches. He's been more of a blocker.
They may use him as an extra blocker because you got to get downfield. You got to get these 5 yards here if you want to get the win.
And Georgia Southern.
Georgia Southern wisely calling the timeout to think about this thing some more.
Timeout.
Overall, Greg, this has just been a dogfight between these two teams. This has been just a war, a battle.
Well, if Georgia Southern does not convert here, the absolute heartbreaker is going to be that you only needed, if you were Georgia Southern, 10 or 15 more yards to put Tyler Bass really in within 50-yard range a couple of minutes ago in regulation. If you had gotten 10 more yards, he would have hit that kick.
Yeah, and that last drive, those first two plays, accumulating for negative yardage, definitely hurt Georgia Southern and putting Tyler Bass in range.
All right, 4th down and 5 for Georgia Southern. They need a touchdown, but they need the first down first. Colby Ransom split to the bottom of your screen. Murray in the slot. Brown the tight end. Wirtz for the end zone on 4th down. It's Mark Michaud! Incomplete? That referee is saying that is incomplete. I thought he had 1 foot in. We're going to have to look at this replay.
Look at that again. I saw a foot in the end zone. That's got to be a touchdown. Let's look at the replay and see what it is.
Let's see.
Make or break time. Gutsy move to go to the end zone here, too.
He only needs 1 foot. This is college.
Caught. Right foot down, touchdown. That should be touchdown.
I think that's going to be a touchdown. There it is. And there's a reason to go to Mark Michaud, Danny. In a physical situation as a receiver, he is 6'4", 220 pounds. He can go up and get it.
It's literally a jump ball. Just throw it up to him and he'll make a play.
Okay, I know that a lot of Georgia Southern Twitter has not been happy with the conservatism of play calling over the last couple weeks. Got to hand it to Bob DeBest there. That was pretty gutsy.
Yeah, it was make or break. It's pretty much a game that can turn your season around.
All right, so if Tyler Bass hits this, we are headed to double OT 2 weeks in a row.
The ruling is a touchdown.
And here's Bass for the tie. That one hooks in. Coastal almost got a hand. Back-to-back weeks. Double OT. Here we come.
And now it's time for Georgia Southern to put the pressure on Coastal Carolina. I mean, just what a gutsy play calling. 4th and 5. You go to the end zone.
I cannot believe that just happened.
At this point, you just got to throw in a playbook and just go with your key guys.
Mark Michaud, by the way, that was only his 4th catch of the regular season. He's not been the main target.
Incredible. The last time Georgia Southern played in an overtime game at home,
it's been a while.
It was in 2010, November 6th, against Appalachian State. They won that game 21-14.
All right, so down to the other side of the field we go. And got a lot of these students who stayed put through the tropical storm. Gotta love the flock.
This is definitely a game where these fans will look back and say, I was here. I was at the Nestor Bowl.
Doesn't quite have the same ring as the Hugo Bowl.
No, but it definitely brings back memories for alumni. For people that played, for the students, the alumni that were at that game 30 years ago, for any former Georgia Southern football players that may have played in that game 30 years ago. Now, the outcome was a little bit different. The Eagles definitely win 45-3, but still, this is nerve-wracking for a Georgia Southern fan.
Holy cow. Okay, so Georgia Southern gets the ball back. They now go first in double overtime on the other side of the field. Kennedy and King behind Wirtz. Safety creeping up. Play action again. Wirtz will go again to Mashad again! Touchdown, Eagles! Bob DeBess is earning that paycheck.
If it ain't broke, don't try and fix it, Greg. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I mean, Coastal's got to be beating themselves up after that. Mashad, once again, deep ball, jump ball to the end zone. Touchdown.
That senior from New York had three catches all year. Now he's got two overtime touchdowns. Got it. Man! All right, Danny, time for Coastal to respond. That momentum just swung back really fast.
Yeah, and for Coastal, it took us some time to get that first touchdown, and not much time at all for Georgia Southern, so it's going to be interesting to see how Carpenter and company try to tie things up.
All right, and here comes Coastal Carolina trying to respond. Their back's against the wall in double OT. They need a touchdown and a PAT. Mirable, it's a fake. They go up the middle of Carpenter. Took it up to the 21. Gain of 4 yards. If Coastal throws, don't forget, both of Southern safeties have been ejected today. Mirable in motion again. It's Carpenter again, and they didn't bite that time. It's Bleem. And all of a sudden, Coastal seemed like they had this game pretty much in the bag. It took Southern going for it on fourth down to even tie the game. And now their backs are against the wall. It's 3rd and 8.
Yeah, it's going to be a big-time decision to see what Coastal does here. At 3rd and 8, do you run? Do you go for the pass? I mean, Carpenter so far today has been 10 of 12, 92 yards, and a touchdown pass, being able to hook up Isaiah Likely.
Coastal is 3 for 12 on 3rd down tonight. Carpenter will run. He's got to get to the 15. He didn't. I think it was a yard short.
Well, he slid it right before any defender could get to him, so he will see if he's going to be short of the first down. He will. So 4th down and...
2?
4th and 3.
4th and a long 2, maybe 4th and 3. Okay. That marker is at the 15-yard line. Coastal needs a first down and then a touchdown if they want to stay alive in Paulson.
And you wonder if Coastal's going to go for it all here for the touchdown.
3 receivers split near side. Highly on the bottom of your screen is their leading receiver, and Jamie Chadwell wants his timeout.
smart decision to silence the crowd here for a moment.
It's not going to work for long.
30-second timeout.
But now you have to wonder, because you saw Georgia Southern risk it all on 4th and 5 go into the end zone. Do you do the same if you're Coastal Carolina? I mean, you can't rely on Carpenter again for the run because the defense has seen it so many times.
All right, 4th and 3, short yardage situation. Georgia Southern's defensive line has been better than Coastal's offensive line in situations like this in the last half hour.
Yeah, and if you're Coastal Carolina, if you want to play it safe, go for the short pass, maybe a slant, 2 or 3 yards, and get the first down.
Or had to go out of the gun and have Carpenter run it.
Well, that's why I just said the defense has seen it so many times. I don't know if they're going to do that again. And that rain is just continuing to pounce down on the field.
Jamie Chadwell is one of the great young offensive minds in this part of the country. You know he's got something drawn up that he's confident in. That's Monquavion Brinson at corner, split to the far side, Kendall Lillor to the near side. Two of the best corners in the group of five. Carpenter out of the gun, that's Mirabal at running back. Three down linemen for the Eagles. Likely in motion. Fourth down, Carpenter will roll and throw. And that's a first down for Coastal Carolina, hauled in by Keyon Tyler, the redshirt senior out of Sumter, South Carolina.
Well, they played it safe. They went to Tyler on a bit of a button hook just to get the first down. I mean, that's the conservative way to go.
Smart way to go.
Smart way to go, too. I mean, now you have more time.
All right, Coastal stays alive. Jeremiah Miller split to the far side of your screen up against Monquavion Brinson. One-on-one matchup. No safety deep back that way. They'll run. Back to Hairston. Not a whole lot doing on that play, maybe 3 yards.
Now keep in mind, the Chanticleers do have room for another first down because the first down marker would be at the 4-yard line.
Yeah, that's right.
So there's not entirely a lot of pressure on the Chanticleers to get the touchdown here, but they want to move the ball.
No matter what happens here, speaking of this guy right here, Bryce Carpenter, their quarterback, no matter how this game ends, he has proved himself worthy of more playing time once Fred Payton returns.
It'll be interesting to see over the next 2 weeks if he becomes a starting quarterback.
2nd and 6. Hairston again. Stopped around the 7-yard line. Didn't quite get there. 3rd down and short.
That's a smart move from Coastal Carolina. If they're able to get 3 to 4 yards each play, get another first down, they're just going to try to scoot their way into the end zone to tie this thing up.
Like you said, Danny, you only need to get to the 4, so this is 3rd down and call it 3. Mirabal in the backfield. That's Hiley, the near side receiver, leads the team in catches. Almost 30 this year. But Carpenter likes to run in this spot, 3rd and 3. Bad option. Here's Mirabal trying to cut upfield. Cuts upfield and into the end zone. That ball's on the ground. Did he break the plane? Looks like he broke the plane. Touchdown, Coastal Carolina.
I think Coastal got the ball back after it was fumbled, but nonetheless, it was an awkward pitch on the option from
that
Coastal.
That was a blown-up play.
Yeah.
The ruling on the field is a touchdown. The previous play.
They're going to look this one over. Let's see what happened. Yeah, fake the inside handoff, went for the pitch. Johnson chasing him down.
Yeah, Raymond Johnson blew that play up, and he broke the plane.
Yeah, but he had 1 foot in the end zone before he let it go, so that's a touchdown for sure for Coastal.
All right, here's Massimo Biscardi. They're looking at the scoreboard that is showing the replay, is what they're showing the referees.
Here's one more look at this play. Left foot was in before he let, I don't know, maybe they're trying to see if he had... If he had it before, the ball went out there before. This is a lot. That's all I can really say.
Yeah, that touchdown was overwhelming, to say the least.
On the field stands. Touchdown.
So this is the interesting thing here. First, Coastal has to knock down the extra point.
And this is Biscardi. Southern's defense has blocked a handful of kicks this year. Can they do it and end this game, or is triple OT in the cards? Biscardi. Good snap. Perfect kick. Triple OT. Here we come at the prettiest little stadium in America.
So this is where the rules have changed, considering from last year. Because after the 7-overtime game between LSU and Texas A&M, they made the change to now starting at the 3rd overtime. After you score a touchdown, you have to go for the 2-point conversion. That's going to change a lot of things here. I'm telling you, once again, credit to all the Georgia Southern fans that made their way out here to Paulson Stadium today for this game. Even the students are going from side to side, keeping up with the action.
And luckily for them, their reward is that after about 3 hours, stop
Georgia
raining.
Southern has chosen defense. If any team can score a touchdown, they must go for a 2-point.
So there you see the official explaining the rules now starting in triple overtime. Georgia Southern is going to start on defense. So Coastal looking to carry that momentum. This has been a well-played game between both of these teams. A lot of defense has been the key throughout this night.
So here we go into triple OT. Back to square. Carpenter's been awfully good in these situations. And very efficient tonight, by the way, 11 for 13. Feed to Hairston. And the defense wraps him up back around the 25.
For Georgia Southern, this is the first triple overtime game since 2012 at Chattanooga, where they won 39-31. And for Coastal Carolina, well, the small run for no gain. And the last triple overtime game they ran was in 2012 at Furman, where they won 47-45.
Variable the motion man, option back to him the other way. Rashad Byrd able to get a hand on him as he jumps down around the 18-17 yard line. Bird's made a couple clutch tackles in the second half.
Yeah, Bird, one of the leaders for this team. Good to see Bird back in because he had to hop off the field there for a moment in the fourth quarter.
He really did, right toward the end.
Yeah.
All right, this is likely split, or rather highly split to the bottom of your screen. Double motion here. Bell, the motion man, tight end. He's the transfer from Clemson. Hairston dives forward down inside the 15-yard line, and that'll move the chains.
Yeah, full head of speed into the lineman. Gets the first down, moving the chains for the Chanticleers.
And I'll tell you, we know entering this game that C.J. Mirabal is the first among equals of their running backs, but Jaquez Hairston's been really impressive.
Yeah, he's done a great job. I mean, only 14 carries. I make it 15 carries now for 41 yards, but he's been able to get the job done when needed for Coastal Carolina.
Three down linemen for Southern. New first down. It's Mirabal. First one to get there on defense, C.J., right after a short game.
And the one thing we didn't really mention there for C.J. Mirabal, even though he hasn't been used that much, he came up clutch, tying the game up in double overtime with that touchdown run.
All right, second down and 8. They'll call that a gain of 2 yards. And the students getting louder. Hairston back in the backfield as the running back. Mirable in the slot on the right side. Linebackers drop into coverage. Second down and eight. That one's knocked away. It was Randy Wade Jr.
Once again, another clutch play by Randy Wade.
Those linebackers have been really great tonight. Whether it be Rashad Byrd or Raynard Ellis, Randy Wade, those linebackers have been key.
The whole interior seven is overall, I mean, they've done a great job here defensively.
All right, third down and eight. They've got to get to the four-yard line to keep this going. Here comes pressure on the edges. Carpenter steps up. Got to get to the four. Not going to get quite there to maybe the 8 yard line.
I mean, you gotta
so that'll bring up fourth down.
You got to get credit to Carpenter, quick on his feet, able to get out the pressure and get some positive yards. And they're bringing out the kicking team, I believe.
Looks like they'll bring out Biscardi, and they will. They'll settle for three. This would make it 27-24 Coastal. That was a low snap, but he's able to put it through. 27-24 Coastal. Now Southern gets the ball back and has the chance to tie or win.
And that works out for Georgia Southern because you can go for the victory, and if you don't get the first down and it's fourth down, you can rely on Tyler Bass with a field goal to keep this game going. Now, I would not be surprised if they go to Mark Rashad again.
Third consecutive time.
Third time's a charm.
Now, for what it's worth, Georgia Southern, those two touchdowns, those were consecutive plays from scrimmage.
Yes.
All right, so from the 25 was the band plays Georgia on my mind. Shy Wirtz in the offense trots back out in that diamond backfield. Three to tie and a touchdown to win. Up to around the 20-yard line. Takes a couple of defenders with him. Not bad on first down. And that was Wesley Kennedy. I'll tell you, no matter how this game ends, Wesley Kennedy's been great.
Yeah, he definitely showed that the Eagles missed him at the first part of the season. And you got to give credit to him and J.D. King, the way they've been running the ball with the absence of Logan Wright.
You got to the 21, second down and six. That's Colby Ransom split to the bottom of your screen. Mashad to the top. Second and six, J.D. King with a head of steam. Linebacker gets to him around the 16-yard line. And if he didn't get it, he's going to be 1 or 2 yards short.
Yeah, I should make it third and one, but if you're Georgia Southern, a simple run up the middle again. We'll get to the first down, plenty of room to work.
It is going to be third down and call it two. Georgia Southern now over 350 yards of offense on the day after that carry. King in the backfield on third and two. Linebackers coming. King stays on his feet to the outside. A first down inside the five to the 2 yard line. And Southern almost has this one ready to go.
How about the toughness of J.D. King? That, at first, looked like a broken play. A great job by the defensive line for Coastal Carolina. But King, able to bounce off one tackle, two, three, four, gets the first down and more, almost into the game right there. So now you only have to go three more yards to win this game if you're Georgia Southern.
All right. It would be back-to-back overtime wins for Georgia Southern after what happened in Mobile. As the rain has started to pick back up here in Paulson. First down and goal. It's Wes Kennedy. Eagles win in triple overtime! But we are now being told there's a flag on the play. This thing might not be done yet. It stands. Eagles win.
What a hard-fought victory for Georgia Southern. My goodness. Triple overtime after a double overtime win at South Alabama. 16 days rest. They fought to the very end. Wesley Kennedy with a game-winning touchdown. And once again, credit to Eagle Nation making their way out here in the midst of all this bad weather going on, too.
Wes Kennedy has a flair for end-of-game dramatics here midway through the season, huh?
Yeah, they did one thing as Arkansas State last season, once again here in Statesboro against Coastal Carolina.
Well, what a game that was. Holy cow, Georgia Southern 30-27 on top of Coastal Carolina, and that'll end it tonight. So for Danny Waugh and Amy Zimmer, I'm Greg Talbot saying so long from Paulson Stadium, where the Eagles win by 3 and move to 500 on the year. All games airing on the ESPN networks are streaming live and archived on the ESPN app. This has been a proud presentation of ESPN.